The NSA in carrying out a secret court order allowing wiretapping of all internet communications at the headquarters of the United Nations, which is an AT&T customer. The documents date from between 2003 and 2013 and were provided by fugitive former NSA contractor Edward Snowden. The documents describe how the NSA's working relationship with AT&T had been particularly important, enabling the agency to conduct surveillance under various legal rules of international and foreign-to-foreign internet communications that pass through network hubs in the United States. According to one NSA document describing the link between the agency and the company, this is a partnership, not a contractual relationship. According to another NSA document, AT&T's corporate relationships provide unique access to other telecoms and internet service providers. AT&T started in 2011 to provide the NSA more than 1.1 billion domestic cell phone calling records daily after a push to get this flow operational prior to the 10th anniversary of 9/11, referring to the September 11th, 2001 attacks on the United States. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
A reclusive deity hasn't written a new book in 2,000 years, and a local rescue dog is adopted for a couple weeks. This is the Onion Week in Review. This week, in a devastating blow to the nation's laundry, 16,000 Americans were reportedly stained during the messiest day in U.S. history. Reports confirm that nearly 3,000 citizens received permanent stains on their good shirt from mustard splatter off a dropped hot dog, along with 12,000 cases of spilled coffee and other dark beverages ruining Americans' pair of hand-wash-only pants. Government officials further indicated that federal assistance for the nation's overwhelmed dry cleaners would be necessary. And in this week's local news, an elderly Rite Aid patron stretches out a conversation about toothpaste to prolong human contact. In other news, artifacts discovered buried in Washington, D.C. suggest humans once passed laws there. A self-centered child blames his parents' divorce entirely on himself. And a night of uninterrupted sleep really throws off a man's entire day.
This is the Onion News Network.
Talk Live.
Hey, it's Free Talk Live. You can dial in toll free here. Bring up whatever you want. We'll give you those numbers here in a little bit. With you tonight, it's Ian.
And Mark.
Of course, it is the live Sunday edition of the program, and you can also join us on Skype. Skype username is lrn.fm. Last night, I teased the story about the MDMA and the DEA. This is actually not fresh news. It is actually a few months old at this point, but it just came across my desk last night, and that is the DEA has now approved a study using MDMA to treat anxiety in seriously ill patients. And I know there are a lot of people who didn't think they were going to see this day in their lifetime. What with the DEA being the same organization who considers marijuana to be as dangerous as heroin.
Well, that's what it's Class A designation, or what is it? Class 1?
It's not called class. Now I'm spacing on what it's called. But yeah, essentially a Class 1 drug. And schedule. Okay. Schedule 1. That's their legal terminology for it. And actually, I don't know what schedule MDMA is on. I think it actually might be on Schedule 2, but that's just... like I said, I haven't seen the listing in a while.
But marijuana is supposed to be as dangerous as heroin.
As heroin. Heroin and marijuana are both...
Cocaine is not.
Cocaine, I believe, is on number 2.
Yeah, cocaine not as dangerous as marijuana. I mean, right. This is the...
Schedule 1 meaning no medically accepted use for whatever it is that's on Schedule 1, which is, you know, obviously ridiculous considering there are all kinds of medical uses for cannabis, and there are over 20-something, 25-plus states where it is legal to use cannabis.
And where doctors decide that you can use it.
Yeah, medical purposes. So obviously the DEA is and the federal government are way behind the clock, way behind the times as far as figuring this kind of stuff out. Although there was the headline, I don't know if you remember this one, Mark, the DEA has an interim administrator.
Oh, yeah.
And he made headlines a few weeks ago for not being sure if marijuana was more dangerous than heroin, or if he said he thought that heroin might be more dangerous than marijuana.
Yeah.
And then about a week later, there was another headline about this guy where he actually came out, and to his credit, he clarified, yeah, sure enough, heroin is more dangerous than cannabis. Now, of course, it's still listed as a Schedule 1 drug.
Yeah, it doesn't change anything.
His opinion, while it is now correct, and he has publicly corrected himself on that, kudos to him for that, because his predecessor never would have said anything like that. But, you know, his opinion has not resulted in a change to the policy that that particular agency is using to continue their enforcement efforts. And anyway, the good news from AlJazeera.com is the DEA has now approved the first clinical trial using MDMA along with psychotherapy to treat anxiety among people with life-threatening illnesses, according to researchers. They told this to Al Jazeera, adding that public support for the therapeutic use of psychedelic drugs is rapidly growing. Brad Burge, the communications director for the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, a.k.a. MAPS, which is a California-based nonprofit research group that studies medicinal uses for psychedelics and marijuana. They're sponsoring this particular study. Brad Burge says the tide has changed for psychedelic research. Unlike ecstasy or Molly, which are names for MDMA sold on the streets and often mixed with dangerous adulterants, pure.
Right. By the way, that's a result of the war on drugs. Not to, you know, it's, people aren't buying ecstasy so that they can have dangerous adulterants. They're buying it so they can experience whatever MDMA is. And the market, you know, because it's the black market, people can't check on what they're getting.
Well, you generally can't check. There are ways to do it. There are laboratories you can send a pill off to. You can also purchase home testing kits. And I believe the folks over at ecstasydata.org have, I think they sell the kits there. There is also a lab that you can send them to. So there are ways to do it. But you're right, Mark. The average user is just going to trust their dealer. They're going to just take the pill. And they're not going to take the...
It's a bad idea.
To do the due diligence to find out if what they are taking is actually what, in point of fact, they think they're taking. But if you're in one of these MDMA studies that the DEA is approving...
You're getting the good stuff.
You don't need to test it. They're going to make sure they get you the right stuff. So, because when something is in the legal marketplace, then, you know, you never have to worry. You never have to worry about cracking open a bottle of Advil, except for that one time in the 80s when it was poisoned.
Tylenol.
Was it Tylenol? I thought it was Advil that got poisoned.
I don't think Advil existed at the time.
In the 80s?
Yep.
I think you're wrong about that, but I think Advil's been around for much longer than the last two decades. But anyway, most of the time, when you grab something off the shelf at your local convenience store, you have about a 100% certainty that it is what it is actually advertised to be. And if it's not, then you've got the basis for a lawsuit, right? So if somebody sells you something that is not, in point of fact, what is advertised on the bottle, that's usually fraud.
Yeah, that's a good chance.
You know, they would probably be found guilty and owe you some sort of compensation for the frustrations. Now, of course, those things don't happen in the black market, because if somebody sells you something that wasn't as it was advertised, well, that person probably didn't know either. Unless it was, you know, unless you were getting your MDMA from the pill presser themselves, then, you know, it's been passed through various different sets of hands since the pill was pressed. And, you know, somebody at some point legitimately doesn't know that's not MDMA. They don't know. And some people have probably been taking what they think is MDMA for their entire life, and there's a good chance they've never actually had the real stuff if they've been taking it in the United States. Tends to be fairly adulterated here and or not even what it is advertised to be.
Ibuprofen came on the market in 1984 in the United States, and the Tylenol drug scare thing was 1982.
It was Tylenol, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, yes, it was definitely Tylenol. Huh. I was alive. You were a child.
Yeah.
I mean, if you, yeah, you were born at that point, right?
Yep. 82, I would have been 2 years old.
Yeah.
Unlike ecstasy or Molly, names for MDMA, the pure MDMA has proved sufficiently safe when taken a limited number of times in moderate doses, says MAPS on its website. The DEA, of course, did not immediately respond to a request for comment. MDMA.
Well, they're letting them do it.
They are. MDMA can be useful in psychotherapy for people suffering from anxiety due to life-threatening illnesses because it produces in users a sense of calm, trust, and confidence, Burge said.
It's also been used for people with PTSD and to help them get over whatever the situation is for them.
Yeah, and it has been incredibly effective in those what I believe were underground trials. I don't think
it's being done in Canada, though. I believe
it is being done on the, I think, on the up and up to some extent in Canada. But there have also been unofficial trials where psychotherapists will, you know, quietly administer MDMA to their patients and do some sort of a therapy session along with that, and having an amazing amount of success rolling back whatever the you know, mental difficulty
is. We should probably not listen to a law enforcement agency when it comes to the medical uses of drugs, and we probably should listen to professionals.
Yep. So MDMA can be useful, and unlike psychedelics such as LSD and psilocybin, MDMA does not produce hallucinations because it is not a psychedelic. It is instead categorized as an empathogen. Yeah. So empathogen meaning the root word empathy. In the trial, 18 subjects diagnosed with life-threatening illnesses will attend months of psychotherapy, with MDMA being used in a few sessions in order to facilitate the process. The outcome will be measured by whether using the drug helps people or helps reduce people's anxiety, which will be determined at the end of the sessions by the patient's feedback and the therapist's assessments. Researchers hope that using MDMA alongside psychotherapy will let subjects confront their situation more clearly and adopt the positive steps they take during the therapy to stick. It opens them up and makes them more comfortable, says Burge, with the therapist, while reducing fear and making them more able to talk about difficult emotions. Now, anybody who's ever used MDMA, they already know that that's true. They know that, you know, this guy is from MAPS is certainly not BSing here. MDMA is a very specific effect, and it affects people, I would say, generally similarly. Now, each individual has different sensitivities to drugs. There was one guy I know who took MDMA for the first time not too long ago, and he had just an amazing experience. He described it as near religious.
Hmm.
Not quite for him, but near religious. A very important experience for him. But for him, he took a dose that lasted 10 hours, which is unheard of.
Yeah, I've never heard of such a thing.
I mean, normally it's like, you know, 3 hours, 4 hours or something like that. Now, of course, it was his first time, and maybe he's super sensitive to it. So, you know, your mileage may vary, and you got to do your research before you get into this. But we'll talk more about this good news coming up here in moments. This is Free Talk Live.
Every once in a while, you get information that's worth changing your life for. This is one such time. You can save up to and beyond 25% on all purchases at Amazon. You probably heard of Bitcoin and just not thought much about it. You certainly know that you can get competitive pricing at Amazon, but now you can get a 25% discount on nearly everything you need to live. I've just given you a huge raise, and all you have to do is claim it. You go to purse.freetalklive.com and open an account. Do this right now. Don't wait. Then you fund the account with Bitcoin. You can buy them through expresscoin.com with a check or money order. There are other ways to get Bitcoin, but that's fast, safe, and easy. This information is worth you changing the way you do things. Go to purse.freetalklive.com right now and get signed up and cash in on the huge raise I'm offering you. 25% off of everything on Amazon through purse.freetalklive.com. It's purse.freetalklive.com.
Sciatica, lower back pain, hip pain, poor posture. If you suffer from any of these problems, get ready to relax. Introducing an amazing product that's been in the market for over 25 years, the Sacro Wedgie. It was invented by a football coach using a common sense osteopath technique. He created this device to help his athletes by isolating and supporting the sacrum, which is the keystone of our anatomy. This wedge-shaped bone is in the center of our hips, where a lot of pain starts. Simply relax 20 minutes daily on the amazingly simple Sacro Wedgie and let gravity do the work, helping muscles rebalance and start releasing nerves. Sit in the sacro wedgie at the computer or while traveling to help correct posture to finally help relieve those stubborn aches and pains for only $33.95. It's made in the USA, so click the family-owned website at sacrowedgie.com, spelled S-A-C-R-O-W-E-D-G-Y.com, or call 1-800-737-9295. That's 1-800-737-9295. Relax your back pain away with the sacro wedgie.
Our digital freedom is under attack. Look no further than Ross Ulbricht's life sentence to see that. After all, it's not Ross's freedom they're after. It's yours.
It is bigger than Ross and bigger than a website. I think one website is by far less dangerous than the government trampling on our rule of law.
The appeal is underway, and we've organized a grassroots fundraiser at thecryptoshow.com/freeRoss. Up for grabs is Cody Wilson's Ghost Gunner, A Week in Costa Rica, My Magic Mud, Ghost Outside the Machine t-shirt.
These prizes are really great. There's a ton more, so go to thecryptoshow.com/freeross. Please tell all your friends, share it up.
Our grassroots tactics allow for 100% of all funds raised to go directly to freeross.org. So check out thecryptoshow.com/freeross. And don't forget freeross.org.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308.
I love My Magic Mud. I drink a lot of coffee. I had stains on my teeth. Then I found My Magic Mud, and I was told it would remove stains. So I paid attention when I brushed the first time. My Magic Mud is black tooth powder, and the difference it made in my teeth in one application was noticeable. With four, my teeth were as white as you normal folks out there. Please go to MyMagicMud.com and buy a jar. There's 150 applications for $25. You can use Bitcoin. MyMagicMud.com.
You can sign up to receive the latest about the Liberty Radio Network via our email updates at updates.lrn.fm. That's updates.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You're invited to join us here on the radio. Our number is 855-450-FREE. Your thoughts on MDMA? Is it on a path towards some level of legalization? That is certainly what the folks over at MAPS would like to see happen, and there is now an approval from the DEA for the Multidisciplinary Association for Psychedelic Studies, MAPS, to conduct tests with MDMA, which is more commonly known as Molly or ecstasy on the streets. MDMA is the more proper scientific shortened term, acronym, if you will. And that's happening. So I'm excited about it. You can share your thoughts toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. And don't forget, we've got Skype. Our Skype username is lrn.fm. Joining you in the studio, by the way, you've got Ian.
And Mark.
And how would you like to get 20-25% off of whatever you want to buy on Amazon? Sound good? Because yeah. It's real.
Who doesn't want to save 20% off on what they buy?
This is real. And the only catch is you have to pay with Bitcoin. So this gives you a reason to get Bitcoin. You've been thinking about getting Bitcoin. Well, now here's a killer reason to do it. 20+% off over at purse.freetalklive.com. So this is how you do it. You go to purse.freetalklive.com, get signed up there, and then whatever you buy through Amazon using Purse, you get tremendous discounts. And I've saved 29% on the headphones that I'm wearing right now. So 20% is the average in the United States, which means you can save more. So go and get started at purse.freetalklive.com. They got an easy video that'll show you how it's done. It's real simple. Purse.freetalklive.com. We're talking about the news about the DEA approving a successful, or what it will be hopefully a successful trial of MDMA. We know that there have been other trials with MDMA helping people with anxiety and PTSD, and this is specifically going to be another anxiety test, probably the first one officially done in the United States. It's part of a larger, it's from AlJazeera.com, part of a larger $20 million plan to make MDMA an FDA-approved prescription medication by the year 2021.
You know, it makes sense that psychiatrists would be able to prescribe this to their patients under the right settings and the right circumstances. I mean, it was an FDA-approved drug in the past, and it's just basically like Washington, D.C. and the fun police, DEA and that sort of thing. And, you know, drugs are going to be used by people recreationally. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a prescription isn't always going to end up the way it's supposed to end up. I get that. That's not a good reason to refuse to allow the drug on the market, period, so people can benefit right from it just because somebody's out there using it recreationally.
Totally agree. If people are partying, that's their issue. If people are getting hooked on something, that's their issue. We know that prescription drugs are dangerous. You know, there are plenty of people who are hooked on oxycodone, for instance.
People die every year from the prescription drugs they're taking properly.
More people die from properly prescribed prescription medication than all of the illegal drug overdoses combined. Like 10 times more.
Yeah.
And so, you know, if you're concerned about safety, then you should be for legalization because it will make those drugs safer, given that people are constantly buying things that are being sold as MDMA or ecstasy on the streets that are not, in point of fact, those things. And that can result in overdoses. That can result in dangerous situations at clubs where people are overheating more so than normal. And it's a dangerous thing to buy these things in the black market. So I'm glad to see that this is happening. And, you know, if it actually does become FDA approved by 2021, I think that will be an amazing, a record-setting timetable for something to move through the government.
It would be amazing.
So we'll see about that. But, you know, good for MAPS for moving ahead with this. They are the only organization in the world that is currently funding MDMA-assisted psychotherapy trials. The Institute has carried out successful pilot studies of MDMA-assisted psychotherapy for post-traumatic stress disorder, adding to the drug's scientific credibility. Other research by the Institute includes ayahuasca-assisted therapy for drug addiction, LSD for cluster headaches, and psilocybin for nicotine addiction. There are many possible uses for all of these supposedly dangerous illegal drugs, and good for MAPS for being out there to try to figure this stuff out. If you want to learn more, I believe their website is MAPS.org, but it's been a little while since I've checked it out. Let's go first to your calls and thoughts. WOBM listener Ralph is on the line in New Jersey. Ralph, you're on the air.
You know, yes. You know, there is a phenomenon, or at least it became a phenomenon overnight, these people that call themselves Black Lives Matter. Now, we know for a fact that they are paid agitators. If you follow the money trail, it points you right into the paymaster, this shady, shadowy character named George Soros. But let me say,
you said a shady, shadowy character, just to be clear.
You know that both sides do this to each other, right? Like there's the Koch brothers on one side and there's George Soros on the other side.
I don't know if he's shadowy. Right, yeah. I mean, he's a billionaire and everybody knows who he is.
Okay. All right. But then, you know, I want to ask the question pertaining to Obama and the Black Lives Matter. Okay, I'm cutting the oil. Well, it goes without saying.
You always call about Obama.
It
go ahead.
It goes without saying now, guys.
And you always get so upset. Very passionate.
Given the fact that Obama has not done anything for the blacks, has, you know, basically, you know, taken them for granted, exploited them as well to advance either a personal or political agenda. At the end of the day, you know, there's a question that's beginning to be asked, and that is, does Black Lives really matter for Obama? I mean, take the issue of Planned Parenthood and Black abortion in this country. He's not taking a, you know, he's supporting Planned Parenthood. He's not saying anything about that. And Margaret Sanger.
I think you've crossed into a couple different issues here, Ralph. So let's slow down for just a moment here. Now, you asked, do Black Lives matter to Barack Obama? And honestly, I don't think anybody's lives matter to Barack Obama, except for maybe his family and, you know, as his most closest friends. But as far as anybody else out there, black people, white people, anybody from anywhere, people, Barack Obama believes he's better than they are because he's the president of the United States, and he will send black and whites alike to die under his command within the U.S. military. So clearly, lives do not matter much to him. They are just simply things to be used to garner political power. And of course, that doesn't make him any different than George W. Bush or Bill Clinton or any of the men who have been in that very same position before him. To them, all of us are just human resources.
You know, we could, a previous president has this thing called the Black Agenda, okay? And we're still waiting. Or at least
I don't know what that means. So who has a black agenda? You said Barack Obama has one?
No, previous
Barack
president.
Obama doesn't have one.
Who has
right?
one?
Barack Obama.
George Bush?
Well, you know, I believe he has done something for blacks. okay?
Like what? I mean, all these people do is increase the power of the state. They're only doing something for themselves. Thanks for the call, Ralph. You know, the people in these political positions, whether it's president or senator or whoever in Washington, D.C., they're not doing anything for you or anything for anybody based on their class necessarily. If they do, they're only doing it because they think it's going to benefit them by getting more votes or something like that. So everything they do is about promoting them, Barack Obama or George Bush or the parties that they're in, the Republicans and Democrats. But share your thoughts here at 855-450-FREE. This is Free Talk Live.
Healthy, organic, fresh fish, robust, mouth-watering vegetables, all from your home. It's called aquaponics. This brilliant, self-sustaining protein and veggie system is perfect for year-round growing. Know exactly where your food is coming from. AquaponicsSource.com is the one-stop shop for all your needs. Fish, fish food, plumbing, full systems, classes, and more. Learn to build your own system. Go to AquaponicsSource.com for a free guide to aquaponics. That's AquaponicsSource.com.
Old female and had a heart attack in 2005. This is Alice from New Jersey. I still get angina, even with four stents. I was taking Nitro two or three times a week. The very first day after taking Heart and Body Extract, the chest pain was gone. Now I don't wear a Nitro patch.
Learn the secrets of an effective, natural, 100% organic nutritional supplement for a healthy heart and circulation at HBExtract.com.
Saying that a few images of displaced refugees would probably do the trick, Americans admitted this week that they could probably be talked into another war. Citizens nationwide told reporters that if they were to see a blurry satellite image of potential nuclear weapons or footage of an evil militant group, they could easily see themselves getting on board with another major military effort.
I'm not saying I'd be gung-ho about it right away, but if they called it something like a concentrated military operation or something other than war at first, I could see myself warming up to the idea. Honestly, just hearing a top official on TV say something like patriotic duty might clinch it.
And in this week's op-ed pages, an area man finds it's just his luck to lose thousands at the blackjack tables every night for the past few weeks. In other news, a senator tries submitting a rejected bill to the Canadian Parliament. What mom would have wanted is evolving over the course of funeral planning. And a new report finds you're actually saving money with a Franklin Skate Center roller rink membership.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is your Robertson Roberts Brokerage Daily Precious Metals Update. In early trading Friday, gold is $3 higher at $1,119 per ounce. Silver is up 7 cents at $15.57 per ounce. Bitcoin is trading at $265. With oil and other commodities sinking, seeing rising prices in gold and silver is very encouraging for precious metals. For more information, give us a call, 800-874-9760, or visit our website at rrbi.co.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at cam.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com. What if the key to achieving liberty in your lifetime was to move together with others who think like you? Liberty activists are joining the Free State Project, which is over 85% of the way to its goal of 20,000 participants. And they're already making the move to New Hampshire. The successes are piling up and are proving the Free State Project is a real movement and no longer just a great idea. When you're planning your move, consider Keene. Keene is famous for its civil disobedience and non-cooperation, and there's plenty of political opportunity as well. If you're a regular reader of FreeKeene.com, you know there's a lot going on in Keene. Keene is the liberty media capital of the world, with television, talk radio, and more, all originating here. Though it's more than just activism, with regular social events each week. See what's happening at FreeKeene.com and get connected with video, audio, free books, a forum, and activist tools you can download and use in your area at FreeKeene.com. That's FreeKeene.com.
What's up next? Visit the Liberty Radio Network program guide to find out at shows.lrn.fm. That's shows.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live allows you to take control of the airwaves if you wish. You may dial in toll-free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. Researchers are hoping to have some research that'll back growing evidence that psychedelics have legitimate therapeutic uses. And there's now a DEA-approved trial that'll be moving ahead that will test MDMA for people with anxiety. Seriously ill anxiety sufferers. And I'm fascinated by these kind of things when they're happening, because I think it really is interesting to see the other side of a lot of these things that we've been told when we were growing up, that this is bad, kids. You shouldn't be doing these drugs. And you probably shouldn't be doing them, kids. But all that said, if you get old enough to do them, then it's not necessarily a bad idea, I think, for somebody to take MDMA. I think that and I agree with a friend of mine who took some MDMA recently, had an amazing experience. He said there ought to be a law. Now, I don't necessarily think it should go that far, and I think that he was joking at that point, but I can understand where he's coming from, because I think for me it was a really important experience in my life to take MDMA for the first time. And I think that if more people would have that experience where they can empathize easier with others and connect better with other human beings, maybe we'd be less likely to be so conflict-oriented. Maybe there would be less war in society. I mean, could somebody who was on a drug like MDMA, which encourages empathy, could somebody like that join the military in that moment? You know, could they go off to fight another human being in that situation? I don't think so. I don't think it'd be possible.
Well, one thing's for sure, most people don't go in the military just to go find somebody to fight. They're probably there to defend. Some do. To defend
some
other folks.
Some join the military because they know they can kill other people legally.
Some do. Yeah. And the other side, too. You know?
I don't think ecstasy is going to cure a psychopath like that, but I think that it could certainly help people be more empathetic.
It helps people who are emotionally damaged, and I'd say that the vast majority of human beings have some kind of emotional damage that they're walking around with, whether they know it or not. And I wouldn't say that it is optimal when used outside of a clinical setting, but it may have some value there, too.
It certainly did for me. Now, of course, if you're going to be doing something outside of a clinical setting, you do want to do as much research as you possibly can. One, start out by going to Arrowid.org, E-R-O-W-I-D, Arrowid.org, great website with all kinds of information about both illegal and legal drugs, prescription, plants, pills. You can go to Arrowid.org to learn a lot more about all of those things. And then further, make sure that you know what you're getting into. Don't just trust the dealer. Learn about drug testing kits and the labs that you can send them off to, that kind of thing. So let's go to your calls and thoughts. And then coming up, the 10 most ridiculous gotchas in the new New York Bit License application. Philip is in North Carolina first, though. Philip, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian and Mark.
Hey, great. Thanks. Just saw the picture of you guys on Facebook talking about the cop wearing the shirt. Well, if you hate cops, call a crackhead next time.
I don't know what picture this is on. This is on our Facebook?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
But I think, you know, the point is to talk about how ridiculous that is. It's a cop wearing that shirt.
Oh, I see.
The fact of the matter is police are always late at the scene of a crime, or they're actually committing crimes themselves. If people were armed, they would be able to respond in a reasonable amount of time rather than calling and then waiting for maybe a law-abiding cop to show up. And these days, you don't really know what you're going
to
get.
Yeah, you certainly can't rely on them to show up. I mean, they whether they're late or not, sometimes they're better than others, depending on the area that you're in and the level of calls, the load of calls that they have. But yeah, usually it's too little, too late when they show up. You're already dead, or whatever has already been, you know, going to be stolen has been stolen.
Police aren't there to stop crimes. Police are there to come and clean up the mess and hand out a little piece of paper to let everybody know what happened.
Did you hear, though, about cell 411, though, Philip?
I haven't.
So you might want to look into this, since you were talking about having other people respond besides the police. Cell 411 is an app that is available for both iPhone or iOS devices and Android devices. You download this, you load up other people that have Cell 411 via their email addresses, and you kind of create different lists of people. So let's say you've got a family list, you've got a neighborhood list, you've got a list of friends or whatever, however you want to break it down. And then if something's happening to you or anyone else that has Cell 411, they can send out an alert to whoever they want. They can send alert to different groups.
Nice.
And then that will send...
You know what? That is exactly what we need to be doing. What is unfortunate here is the state, the sense of statism. People are just becoming more and more dependent upon the state to where it is becoming so corrupt, and they use that power and become corrupt through that power, when in fact, the way the Constitution was written was not for this police state, which has really turned into the military. I'm sure you're familiar with Jade Helm and what's going on there, but What is really happening here is that people have refused to take responsibility for their own protection and for their own family.
That's true.
In addition to the government trying to come in and take their weapons away so that they can't do that and be completely dependent upon the police. So that's a great app. I'm going to look into that.
Yeah, I think it's all of 99 cents for that app, and we're using it here in the Keene area. And, of course, the more people that use it, the more useful it becomes. And from what I understand, version 2 is on the way in like 2 weeks, and it's going to get even better. So, Philip, thanks for the call tonight. Again, that's Cell 411, C-E-L-L, and then 411. Search for that in your favorite app store. Thanks for the call. Our toll-free number tonight is 855 450 free. I've got Cell 411 on my phone, and we need to get more people on board with that. I think it's a really powerful
application. Seems like a great idea.
Yeah, you can send out different kinds of alerts, like, you know, there's a medical emergency, I'm being harassed by the police. I mean, there's a bunch of different ones that they've got there. Very, very handy stuff. So whether you want to talk about the police and their poor, you know, response time in some cases, or MDMA, you're welcome to join us here. Our Skype username is lrn.fm. And, you know, it'd be nice if you could, you know, if you could count on the police to show up within a certain amount of time. But in order to have a level of response like that, you need to have a contract. There needs to be some sort of level of expected performance from the agency in order for, you know, for it to have that level of competition to where they'll rise to that to that occasion. And the police with the government just don't have that because they're a monopoly. They don't have any real competition because they know that you're going to pay for their service whether you like it or not.
Right. If you compare police to, say, private security organizations, with private security organizations, if they fail to protect the property, they're bonded, they're insured, and they're, you know, they may have to pay up depending on the liability in that situation. If your house gets burglarized and you believe the police are there to help you, to protect you, well, do you ever put a claim into the police because your house got burglarized? No. No one would ever even think of doing that because they know that the police are not responsible. Policing agencies are not responsible to protect your house. However, if you hired a security agency, you could have it in the contract that, look, either you pay me back for the stuff that got stolen or, you know, whatever. You're responsible for it in whatever way. That's a possibility in the contract. Certainly, I'm sure these agencies would step up. But instead, I'm forced to pay for the police because they're here to help us all.
Yeah, and if you're not happy with the police and, you know, you want something done about it, well, good luck with that, because you better start contacting your state representatives and your city councilors. And
they'll just tell you to move.
Start up a campaign. Well, not necessarily, Mark. They may placate you with, you know, saying they'll talk to, I'll have a chat with the police chief about this.
I'm on this.
Yeah. And, you know, nothing's going to change ultimately unless you are somebody with the political sway to actually have something change, right? Like if you're in with the city manager or the city councilors and you've got political connections.
It's nigh impossible for politicians to change bureaucracies.
All right, our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE, 855-450-3733. What does it take to get the new Bit license that's coming out in New York State? This is the thing that's driving the Bitcoin businesses out of the state. We'll tell you about it coming up.
I'm Steve Sitkowski, a former Wall Street insider. I'm holding a book that will show you investing strategies which could help you earn the kind of money you've always dreamed about. And right now, I'm giving this book away for free. So who needs to read it? If you're in the middle of your career and worry you'll never have enough money to retire, you need to read this book. If you're already retired and your income isn't enough, you need to read this book. And if you don't want to be selling burgers at 80, you need to read this free book. It includes the strategy I use to make a 72% profit on a trade where the stock only moved 12%. You'll need at least $1 million to ever fully retire. If you're behind on that goal, you really need to read Trade Like the Pros. And you can for free by calling 1-800-944-5836. Skeptical that it will deliver results? It's a free book, so what do you have to lose? Find out how at 1-800-944-5836. 1-800-944-5836.
Silver has always been nature's very own antibiotic, and only one system allows you to produce an endless supply of nano-sized silver solutions right from the convenience of your home. Silver Lungs. With the addition of our unique lung delivery system, respiratory infections are targeted directly, where traditional oral administration simply cannot reach. This pioneering method also preserves the original particle sizes and delivers your silver solution directly into the bloodstream. See the Silver Lungs generator and lung delivery system at silverlungs.com. That's silverlungs.com.
Planning to buy food storage? Wait a minute. Many companies try to confuse you with the number of servings they sell. It's not about the number of servings, it's about the number of calories. In emergencies, calories mean survival. Go to ReadySupplyFoods.com for a comparison of leading companies. Ready Supply Foods sells the most calories per dollar of any company. Our 23 entrees and breakfasts are delicious and full of nutritious calories. The new leader in value and quality. Go to ReadySupplyFoods.com today.
Since time began, tyrants have taken aim at personal liberties. Now there's a movie that aims back.
The government has no more right to tell us what to put in our bodies than they have to take our guns or tell us what books we can read.
Six drug police were eaten by bears while raiding a marijuana farm.
On your knees, you dirty hippies!
Jesus.
On your knees!
What's the problem, officer?
Today, many cops who enforce pot laws do so only because it provides them with cushy jobs, good benefits, and a chance to push people around.
I was an undercover narcotics officer. The drug war is nothing but a farce.
The Second Amendment says you gotta keep you and your gat intact.
Guns and Weed, the Road to Freedom. A film by Michael W. Dean and Nima Vadavi.
DVD available now at gunsandweed.com or on Amazon. That's gunsandweed.com. Makes the perfect gift. Remember, that's gunsandweed.com.
LRN.fm is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and iOS devices. Now you can easily tune into our streams anywhere, anytime on your smartphone or tablet. Just visit apps.lrn.fm or search for LRN.fm in the Android or Apple app stores. Please download, rate it 5 stars, then share the link on social media, and let your friends and family know how you're listening to LRN.fm. Download it now, free, at apps.lrn.fm. That's apps.lrn.fm.
Ross Ulbricht was convicted in early 2015 of running the infamous Silk Road Underground Market. The Silk Road was a gift to humanity and helped reduce the harms brought on by drug prohibition. For this good deed, Ross has been sentenced to life in prison with no possibility of parole. Now, an appeal is Ross's only chance, and he needs your support. Please visit FreeRoss.org, where you can contribute via various methods, including Bitcoin. Visit FreeRoss.org. That's FreeRoss.org.
If you enjoy LRN.fm, please contribute to your favorite shows via their websites and become an amplifier at amp.lrn.fm. That's amp.lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You can join us here on the radio waves at 855-450-FREE. Coming up, the 10 most ridiculous gotchas in the New York BitLicense application. This is the new thing that is coming to businesses in New York State. Businesses who are the type of folks who are doing like Bitcoin exchanges, running big Bitcoin businesses like that. And it's driving them out of there. These guys are hitting the road and finding a place to open up shop.
that is more friendly to the Bitcoin universe. And we'll give you 10 of the reasons why people are saying the hell with this. And
New York is basically the center of the economics in the United States. And if they're driving away new emerging markets, that's important.
Yeah, so we'll share some of those with you coming up here. You can also join us via Skype. Skype username here is lrn.fm. Maybe you're ready to get some Bitcoin. You've heard us talking about Purse, where you can save purse.freetalklive.com, where you can save 20% or more on Amazon products when you pay with Bitcoin. Did you know now there's also Bitcoin Jesus, Mark? I was talking with him the other night, Roger Veer. There's now a way to save 20% at Starbucks with Bitcoin.
No, I didn't
hear about that one.
Yeah, you said something about it, but I...
Yeah, Fold App is what it's called.
Fold
Fold, as in F-O-L-D, foldapp.com. They actually go to coffee.foldapp.com. It looks super simple. I don't go to Starbucks, really, but I'm thinking about going just to test out how easy this system looks. Saving 20% on Starbucks. I mean, there are people out there who go to Starbucks every single day. Can you imagine them saving 20% at Starbucks, how much that would add up to on a daily habit?
A great deal.
Yeah, you used to go to Starbucks regularly, right?
Yeah, it's been some time, but yes.
Would have been a big deal if you could save 20%. So if you're ready to get some Bitcoin, go to ExpressCoin. ExpressCoin.com. It's fast, safe, easy, and inexpensive. You can get your Bitcoin there, and you can actually get up to $40 worth for no transfer fee. Because normally when you transfer money, you're paying a transfer fee of whatever percentage. Zero fee when you use code FTL over at ExpressCoin.com. Whether you're in the U.S. or Canada, you can use a money order or a check through ExpressCoin.com. They've even got their own app that you can download. If you go over $40, then I think the fee is all of 3%. So you do the math. Save 20% at Starbucks, save 20% at Amazon, pay 3% for the Bitcoin. You're saving 17% there, which is pretty sweet. So get started at ExpressCoin.com. Don't forget coupon code FTL as we go to the phones and the fun. We got a Mike listening in Michigan. Mike, where are you at? Grand Rapids?
Yeah, Grand Rapids area in Michigan.
Welcome, sir. You're listening to WTKG. Go ahead with your thoughts.
Yeah, just agreeing with you that regulation slows down the economy. We saw it in New York, and from what you're saying, they're starting to regulate Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a frictionless way to move the economy. New York failed with Uber. They're trying to regulate it, but the people said, wrong, we want our Uber. And, you know, that's the way we move the economy forward. Disruptive innovation defeats regulation.
Yeah, it generally does. Unfortunately, the Uber guys are spending probably billions of dollars on legal fees and attorneys just to try to kind of stay in business with all of the various different attacks against them. And I mean, I'm presuming it's billions, maybe it's hundreds of millions. Seems like a lot of money because they're under fire from every which way. They just got their offices raided in Hong Kong. Hundreds of drivers have had their cars stolen in New York City from Uber. So I agree with you. Innovation is super important. Disruptive technology like Bitcoin that is a real kind of game changer technology. This is super, super important stuff. And the government usually is late to the game at being able to regulate these things, thankfully. So they're able to get off of the launching pad without being crushed under the boot of the state. It's just once they get off that launching pad and start making millions of dollars, then all of a sudden the old money interests and the old businesses like the taxi cab companies, in the case of Uber and whatever other government connected agencies there are, they all of a sudden take notice because, well, now money's being transferred and they're not getting the same cut that they're used to. So they get very upset about that.
I agree. And similar to your prior point about bureaucracies, bureaucracies will always be created and innovative organizations will show up. I mean, I think that Google and Apple are real threats, and Tesla, threats to the automotive industry. These are new ideas, not coming out of the standard industry. Similarly, in healthcare, I think everybody's, you know, fatalistic about Obamacare. But meanwhile, I just read an article about Heal.com. For $100 in some cities, you can have a physician show up at your house. I mean, there are ideas and concepts. Yeah, and this is disruptive innovation. You know, I think people in the next 5 to 10 years, they'll buy the cheapest, required insurance required. And then meanwhile, they'll go online and have physicians all over the world issuing opinions on their condition with high-def, high-resolution images in high video conversations, and all of a sudden Obamacare will be like, hold on, you have to go to the hospital. And people are saying, no, we've got this new idea. And it costs $100 to talk to a physician.
The US, very cool. The USB blood pressure cuff, the USB rectal thermometer.
Wait, do they have those?
Amen, brother.
Hey, Mike, thanks for the call. Good call. I appreciate hearing from you tonight. Our toll-free number is 855-450-FREE. But sometimes, though, for the innovative ideas, you can look to the past, like mutual aid. I think that's what's going on with Liberty HealthShare, right?
Yeah, with Liberty HealthShare, what it is, it's a health share organization. And these are completely legal under the Obamacare rules. They've been around significantly longer. And for my family, it's been a really great thing. The cost-wise between this and health insurance, it's about half. And, you know, I mean, we get the same.
Why is that? They don't have the overhead?
I think it's the overhead, yeah.
Because these insurance companies are behemoths with all kinds of staff that they're
paying.
You're
also able to set up, you know, deductibles in the way that you want, and, mm-hmm. and you're not paying for services that you don't need and a variety of other things. Okay. So it's cutting out a lot of waste. And it's just right for us. So you can check it out, see if it's the right thing for you. If you're paying for your own insurance, I would suggest that it is. So it's probably worth a little bit of time to check it out. Just go to libertyhealthshare.org. It's libertyhealthshare.org. You can give them a call. This is what worked for us. We had somebody explain it to us on the phone. Bang, it made perfectly good sense. 855-58-LIBERTY, 855-58-LIBERTY, libertyhealthshare.org.
Let's go to Clayton. He is on the line via Skype. Clayton, you're on Free Talk Live.
Hey, fellas. I wanted to call in tonight and talk to you guys about the concept of dual citizenship. I know that you likely both don't really agree with citizenship as a concept, but since it exists, my wife and I are considering giving birth to our child outside of the United States in a country that offers birthright citizenship. If you can talk a little bit about what advantages or disadvantages you would see in dual citizenship for our kid.
Well, I would think that you would know some of the advantages. You're the one who's deciding to do it. So what are some of the advantages of that? I've never looked into it.
So some of the advantages that are quite obvious, you diversify your passport portfolio, right?
Yeah, that's probably the biggest one.
Another one is just opens up opportunities for our son or daughter if they decide they want to live or work in a place outside of the United States. It becomes a lot easier, at least for one other country. Another benefit that I see that's a little more out there is, you know, things get really crummy in the United States and it's harder for U.S. citizens to leave or go somewhere else. It's a lot easier if you have that second passport.
Yeah, well, once again, we're talking about passports here. The thing is your passport can be taken away for something as simple as, you know, tax issues that you don't even know about. And that's pretty scary when, you know, you're talking about maybe you don't live in the United States. This has happened to people who have dual citizenship and, like, live in Canada. Young people who are, you know, just going along, doing life and whatever, and the United States government decides, you owe us money. Well, wait a second. I've never even been to the United States. I don't know what you're talking about. I don't owe you money. The United States is unique in that it demands taxes from its citizens, income taxes, if you live outside the country. Now, you have to make a certain amount of money, and there's all kinds of different rules that I don't know them all, and neither do you. Anybody listening to me, you don't know what the tax rules are, and it's incredibly frightening. So I think what the advantage of United States citizenship is, it's really easy to travel around the world. Your passport's good just about everywhere. The disadvantage is that the government will take it away whenever they darned well feel like it. There's nothing you can do.
What is the disadvantage of dual citizenship? It sounds like all the advantages are in its corner.
Yeah, I actually can't think of any. That's why I was hoping
traveling, maybe
you guys could
all the
some.
Travel trouble that you're going to have to go through. I mean, wherever you are now is probably the easiest place for your wife to give birth. And if you're going to travel someplace else just for this, it's going to kind of be a pain, and you may be away from work.
All right, so you'll have to be in that place for probably a good solid month, right? Like, you know, whenever the delivery is due is when you have to go down there. Just real quick, where are you thinking about going to have that baby?
Well, easiest would be Mexico or Canada.
The Mexican passport, not that useful.
Hey, thanks thanks for the call tonight, Clayton. I appreciate hearing from you. And you can join us here. Hour number two is on the way. This is Free Talk Live, the live Sunday edition, 855-450-FREE.
If worst comes to worst,
Will you be prepared? You don't have to be a survivalist to prepare for the unexpected. Storing necessary supplies like food, water, and emergency equipment is simply taking responsibility for ourselves and our families when it counts the most. StrategicShelters.com offers emergency supplies and a secure way to store them, and provides protection for loved ones in the event of an extreme natural or man-made disaster. To find out more, visit StrategicShelters.com.
Kid, let me paint you a picture. Tuesday night, your cog belt goes bust. Who will help you get what you need fast, without the hoops, hurdles, or headaches? Grainger, that's who. I love Grainger. They got a wide variety of products and solutions. Grainger makes it easy to get everything we need, and answers for when we're not sure what the answer is. Now, kid, let me paint you another picture. It looks like a mop, a basement bathroom, and you, all over it. Get it? Got it? Good. Call clickgrainger.com or stop by. Grainger, for the ones who get it done.
If worst comes to worst, will you be prepared? You don't have to be a survivalist to prepare for the unexpected. Storing necessary supplies like food, water, and emergency equipment is simply taking responsibility for ourselves and our families when it counts the most. StrategicShelters.com offers emergency supplies and a secure way to store them, and provides protection for loved ones in the event of an extreme natural or man-made disaster. To find out more, visit StrategicShelters.com.
The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. You likely buy all kinds of things online. Amazon is the largest online retailer. You can get what you need at the same prices with free Super Saver shipping by going to shop.freetalklive.com. Please do your online shopping at shop.freetalklive.com.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number two is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Sunday, August 16th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.26 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,115 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $261. Antiwar.com reports several months into the Saudi Arabia-led war against Yemen's Shiite Houthis, the pro-Saudi faction, the former government led by Abd Rabu Mansour Hadi, has gained a little bit of territory around Aden, and that has raised international calls for some sort of settlement leading to elections. That's not seemingly likely, however, with Hadi government officials still talking up a full-scale military victory nationwide after having taken one city and some nearby towns. The group's ambassador to the UN says victory is assured. Ambassador Ali Mani said of the Houthis, "They are on the run," adding, "My feelings is this is going to be weeks before we can liberate the entire country from the coup." Regional diplomats aren't nearly so optimistic and are urging the two sides to talk and settle things. Hadi was a military leader elected in a single candidate vote in 2013 after the Arab Spring resignation of longtime dictator Ali Abdullah Saleh. Hadi resigned himself in January after an offensive against the Houthis turned sour and the Houthis took over the capital. The UN already brokered one round of peace talks in Switzerland, but it failed when the two sides would not meet in the same room. The only time they were together turned ugly when Hadi envoys attacked a Houthi spokesman at a press conference. Bitcoin Not Bombs is a launching pad for nonprofits and social entrepreneurs into the financial freedom of the Bitcoin economy. Bitcoin Not Bombs is fully committed to being the hub of the nonprofit sector of the Bitcoin economy. To learn more, visit BitcoinNotBombs.com. UPI reports flights in airspace along the East Coast were disrupted for hours on Saturday due to a technical glitch at the Federal Aviation Administration's Northern Virginia Control Center. Officials said the glitch occurred in an automated system at the agency's Air Traffic Control Center in Leesburg, Virginia, affecting flights leaving and arriving at multiple airports in the New York City and Washington, D.C. areas. As those airports are responsible for a great share of the East Coast air traffic, the glitch caused cancellations, delays, and reroutes routes, according to the FAA. Just after 2 p.m. Eastern Time on Saturday, the agency said the system was back online. The New York City area airports operate traffic for some of the most congested airspace in the world. The FAA did not specify exactly how many flights were disrupted, but it did say the glitch was not a result of a security breach.
For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
Reuters reports telecommunication powerhouse AT&T has provided extensive assistance to the U.S. National Security Agency as the spy agency conducts surveillance on huge volumes of internet traffic passing through the United States. The New York Times reported on Saturday, citing newly disclosed NSA documents, that the company gave technical assistance to the NSA in carrying out a secret court order allowing wiretapping of all internet communications at the headquarters of the United Nations, which is an AT&T customer. The documents date from between 2003 and 2013 and were provided by fugitive former NSA contractor Edward Snowden. The documents describe how the NSA's working relationship with AT&T had been particularly important, enabling the agency to conduct surveillance under various legal rules of international and foreign-to-foreign internet communications that pass through network hubs in the United States. According to one NSA document describing the link between the agency and the company, this is a partnership, not a contractual relationship. According to another NSA document, AT&T's corporate relationships provide unique access to other telecoms and internet service providers. AT&T started in 2011 to provide the NSA more than 1.1 billion domestic cell phone calling records daily after a push to get this flow operational prior to the 10th anniversary of 9/11, referring to the September 11th, 2001 attacks on the United States. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
Officials at PepsiCo announced today the upcoming launch of Mountain Dew Cineblast after the company's market research team unknowingly fell victim to a malicious focus group that convinced them cinnamon-flavored Mountain Dew was the next big thing.
We were the people in the focus group. They couldn't get enough of it. And then they said, the more cinnamon, the better. So we are going to put in more cinnamon. We are really excited for people to try this product.
According to PepsiCo's data, all gathered from a single group of ill-intentioned respondents, customers of all ages will love the new soft drink's murky brownish-green color and will soon be lining up to try the carbonated beverage jam-packed with ground cinnamon. Various members of the focus group told reporters they believed the company had made a great decision.
Cineblast is the best. I mean, I can't wait to tell all of my friends to go buy this thing.
Yeah. The only way they could make it better is if they took a couple of raw eggs, mixed them up in the bottle. People would go nuts.
This is the Onion News Network.
Free Talk Live.
This is Free Talk Live. You're invited to join us here on this live Sunday edition of the program. With you tonight, you've got Ian.
And Mark.
And the toll-free number for you, 855-450-FREE. Coming up, the 10 most ridiculous gotchas in the New York BitLicense application. Again, though, you can comment on anything you want to discuss, 855-450-FREE. Let's go to the phones and your calls and thoughts. Dana is on the line in Grand Rapids, listening to WTKG. Hello, Dana.
Hi, guys. Hey, Ian, I have a couple questions for you. You were talking before the break about regulation of against, you know, like Bitcoin, for example, and Uber. Mm-hmm. You mentioned those two specifically. My two questions to you is, shame on you, Ian. If they don't regulate it, wait a minute. I'm going to get there. Shame on you, Ian. If they don't regulate that stuff, how will they control us? And then the next question is, how are they going to pay back all those big donators like unions with the cap companies if they don't heavily regulate us?
Yeah, well, obviously they don't like the idea that you'll have more freedom, so they want to try to regulate those things. But with something like Bitcoin, it's out of their hands. They basically can't regulate Bitcoin. New York's trying, and what they're doing ultimately is they're going to regulate the Bitcoin businesses that are based in New York, specifically the exchange-type businesses, as I understand it. And so that's just simply driving them out. But they can't actually regulate Bitcoin. New York cannot take control of Bitcoin. They are completely unable to shut it down. They can't force their way upon Bitcoin itself. Bitcoin is essentially, it's a currency and it's a financial network, and it is completely insulated from government regulation and government attack, which is, of course, what makes one of the things that makes Bitcoin super awesome. Dana, other thoughts? Go ahead.
Just that, you know, of course, you know I was being facetious.
Yes, clearly.
It's just, I guess my only last parting thought would be the next time anyone needs a cab, call Uber.
Thanks, Dana. Appreciate it. I've had good experience with the Uber. I've never tried Lyft. I've never tried Sidecar, but Uber I've gone on twice. When we were in Austin, we took a Uber a couple of times.
Yeah,
and it's great.
The times I've used it, it's been fine.
They get that that thing where you can refer people and get free rides. So
that's cool.
Yeah, out of nowhere, I must have shared my referral link back in Austin, which would have been 3 months ago or something like that. I think that was the only time I shared the link that they give you when you sign up for Uber. Like, mm-hmm. Hey, you share this link and anybody that gets, you know, signs up for Uber, you'll get a free $20 credit or something like that. And in my email the other day, literally last week, bing, you know, you got something from Uber, free ride. Somebody signed up with your code, which, you know, they don't do that with their traditional cab companies.
They certainly won't. I guess the worst thing about Uber for me was there was a time in New York City when I couldn't get my, it was cloudy and I couldn't get my phone to sort of.
To know where you were.
Yeah, the GPS just kept floating all over the place. And
I think there's a way around that. I think you can actually like select the spot, like if you knew where you were on the map, that you could somehow select that place as like, I will be here, right? Like, so if let's say you're in a meeting and like, even if your GPS is working right, I think you can do this. Maybe if you're more familiar, you can call and correct me if I'm wrong. But let's say you're in a meeting and you're down the street from where you want to get picked up later and you want to schedule, you know, for 10 minutes or whatever, you can tell them I'm going to be at this location and then they'll meet
at that time.
I think I could be wrong about that.
Yeah, I'm sure you could. I just,
if not, that sounds like it'd be relatively easy to program into to that system.
They should do that.
So share your thoughts here. 855-450-FREE. We're talking about technology and innovation, and Bitcoin is certainly at the top of the field of technology and innovation these days. Now, there's actually something going on behind the scenes sort of in the Bitcoin world right now that is relatively controversial, and maybe we'll talk more about that once we get a better handle on exactly what it is, but there's sort of a division between some of the Bitcoin programmers about the future of Bitcoin and what it's going to look like, and there people are taking sides in this very important decision that will ultimately come to a head apparently within the next several months. So we'll keep you in the loop on that. It's called a Bitcoin fork, as they call it in the business. And we can tell you more about that.
It's a big forking deal.
Yeah, it sure is, as it develops. But Bitcoin rolls on unaffected at the moment, and although the price is down a little bit, which may have something to do with the news about this fork. Or maybe, you know, you never know what's going to bring the price up or the price down. But I can tell you one thing's for sure. It's this BitLicense in New York is driving Bitcoin businesses the hell out of the state. Here's the story from dinbits.com. On June 3rd, the New York Department of Financial Services issued its final virtual currency license rule, aka the BitLicense, after nearly 2 years of debate and feedback. August 8th ended the 45-day grace period allotted for operations related to transactions involving any form of digital currency to operate without a license. The license, the so-called BitLicense, is required for any individual or business to conduct any form of business activity with New York State or a resident of or business within the jurisdiction of the state of New York, in the state of New York, from any other state in the United States, or from any other country in the world, as defined by the regulations of whatever, in full effect of August 9th as of this year. So actually, it sounds like it's even more wide-cutting than I thought. It's saying that any business, any individual conducting any form of business within New York State regarding Bitcoin. Maybe it's much worse than we previously believed, Mark, but the
what do you mean? I thought that it was terrible for people inside of the state of New York.
I had thought it was going to only be targeting the exchanges. I thought it was only a select group of Bitcoin businesses. It was my understanding that the previous discussions had said that if you were, let's say, a retailer who is accepting Bitcoin at your point of sale, that this Bit license would not be required for that. Now, I haven't read the regulations. That's just the summary from dinbits.com. So maybe they got it wrong or whatever, but it sounds worse now than what it was originally pitched as being the last time we talked about this on the show. So keep that in mind. The application is 31 pages.
It's like you need
pages.
A license to accept. Do you need a license to accept Canadian currency in your business
No.
if you're in New York? Do you need a license to accept U.S. currency? Do you need a license to accept euros? The idea that the state of New York says that you've got to have a license to accept Bitcoin is reprehensible.
If that's what it says, we'll see if we can verify that claim here by DinBits. But they do have the 31-page long application, which requires additional documents, some that will accrue additional costs, and must be completed in its entirety at the risk of forfeiture of the $5,000 required application fee. How many people can afford a $5,000 fee just to apply to get a license? Now, remember, after you've paid that $5,000 fee, they can come back to you and say, here on page 30, paragraph C, section 2, you didn't initial that. Application denied. You're free to try again for another $5,000 application fee. You think I'm joking? They certainly can do things like that.
They do things like that. I mean, but they shouldn't, but, you know, this is the problem with these licenses.
Incomplete applications are returned with an itemized list of necessary documents and or materials required to be considered a complete application. What will not be returned is the 5,000 smackers. Most of us have heard about this legendary non-refundable $5,000 application fee, but that's nothing compared to the other hidden gems in this document. Here are the real gotchas, David Letterman style. The 10 most ridiculous gotchas in the New York BitLicense application. Number 10, the $5,000 non-refundable fee. This one's out of reach for a lot of startups.
Yeah.
But it's a bad joke because this is really the least of their worries, being one of the less expensive things about the BitLicense. Number 9, 15 years worth of work history is required. What about people who are independently wealthy and haven't done a damn thing for somebody else in 15 years?
Yeah, I don't think that's a problem. I think you can just say, you know, hey, I wasn't doing anything.
Uh-huh. Do you think that'll get you approved?
I don't think it'll. Look, my experience in these things is they just want you to put things on the lines.
Well, this isn't your average license application, Mark. This is a new license that they are likely going to be paying close attention to. This
Could
isn't
be.
Just going to be something where some bureaucrat is shuffling papers.
I'm still more worried about the $5,000.
What about people who've only worked for 7.5 years? Almost as ridiculous as Big Brother.
You write down high school and college on it.
Number 8, permission to contact every company you've ever worked for. Yep, including the McDonald's manager where you may have worked in high school. Let's hope you didn't upset him. He might still be there. There's also a kiss your privacy goodbye form that must be signed, stating that the New York Department of Financial Services can go ask any question that they want to and acquire every juicy detail about any position you held at any company for the last 15 years. We will get to the other 7 most ridiculous things in the BitLicense application for New York State. Coming up, it's Free Talk Live.
This message is for home intruders, the cowards who break into people's homes to steal their hard-earned property. Criminals who shatter lives and rob people of their privacy and security. Listen very carefully. We're the home security experts at LiveWatch, and we're taking you down. Because we're letting everyone try our newest home security system for one full year in their home. To take advantage of this amazing offer, call now, 1-800-670-9259. LiveWatch has been helping protect homes for years, and we've learned the secrets that intruders like you don't want people to know. Criminals, it's time for you to be afraid, because every person who calls will be protected against cowards like you. To the criminals listening, we're taking you down. To those who want to help protect their homes, call the security experts to try the LiveWatch security system. There are no long-term contracts, and if you're not completely satisfied, you can cancel at any time. Try LiveWatch now by calling 1-800-670-9259. That's 1-800-670-9259.
Okay, honey, I have to ask, and be honest here. Have you been taking a little blue pill? Because things have been
pretty good in the bedroom lately.
No, I swear.
You didn't pick anything up at the Pharmacia last month in Cancun?
No.
Well, something's different.
I have been taking that heart and body extract you bought me.
But that's for your heart and to control your cholesterol.
Well, I read HB extract also promotes healthy prostate function.
I never guessed it would work this well, but
you're glad it did.
Oh, yeah.
Heart and Body Extract is a 100% organic formula that promotes a strong heart, healthy arterial flow, better circulation, improves erectile and prostate gland function, and provides youthful energy, strength, and stamina. Find out more at heartandbodyextract.com. Heart and Body Extract, paired with healthy heart choices, is a winning combination. Call toll-free to order or for free information. 1-866-295-5305. 1-866-295-5305.
The warning signs.
First, he made me feel special. He promised he'd look after me, provide for my future. He broke every promise he made.
Millions of Americans afflicted.
I was ready to leave, but he told me he'd change. So I gave him another chance. I was such a fool.
The consequences.
Things only got worse. He started making my decisions for me about my job, my kids' education, my money. My safety, my future. He took away my choices, but I kept going back to the same politicians.
The diagnosis? Battered voter syndrome.
I fell for the same old lies. They were just playing with my emotions, telling me what I wanted to hear. That's not right.
Stop the insanity of voting for the same old abusers. Declare your independence from the two-party system and join the New Hampshire Liberty Party today. At nhliberty.info. If you want to know the latest about Free Talk Live before we go on the air, all you need to decide is how you want it delivered. It's your choice. Visit news.freetalklive.com. You can get emailed announcements and participate in contests via our email updates list. Plus, we have a Twitter account that you can follow and a Facebook page where you can become a fan. So visit news.freetalklive.com to get news about Free Talk Live as soon as it's announced and the way you want it delivered at news.freetalklive.com. That's news.freetalklive.com. So you've signed the Shire Society Declaration and are planning your move to New Hampshire to be around more liberty-oriented people. Next, sign up for the Shire Society Forum at forum.shiresociety.com. There are a bunch of people there who are already in the Shire, and they want to meet you. If you're already in the Shire physically, you should also come by the forums. Remember, not everyone uses Facebook. New people are signing up for the Shire Society Forum every month, so drop in and say hello at forum.shiresociety.com.
You can watch the LRN Studio Cam and chat with other listeners anytime at cam.lrn.fm. That's cam.lrn.fm.
As New York State prepares to strangle what few Bitcoin businesses remain there, going over the 10 most ridiculous gotchas in the New York BitLicense application. This thing just went into effect on August 9th after a 45-day grace period for people who are doing transactions with Bitcoin. And I'd like to know more about to whom this license applies, because it's 30-something pages, 31 pages, according to dinbits.com. We're going to tell you more about it here in just a moment. I also want to let you know, if you're interested in Bitcoin, whether you are a beginner or an expert, Bitcoinist.net is the ultimate resource for Bitcoin industry news, reviews, education, and the latest in the cryptocurrency ecosystem. Their website, Bitcoinist.net, integrates a community forum, breaking Bitcoin and digital currency news. They've got fintech and blockchain tech news as well, and a very sophisticated Bitcoin network statistics, a solid beginner's guide to Bitcoin, and more. Bitcoinist's platform serves the need of everyone who's looking to keep up with Bitcoin and digital currencies. From beginners to experts, go to Bitcoinist.net. That's Bitcoinist.net. As we continue here, just an example of what these poor bastards who are staying in New York are going to have to deal with if they want to do business in Bitcoin. The 10 most ridiculous gotchas in the 31-page-long BitLicense application. Number 7, I'll recap real brief. Number 10, the $5,000 non-refundable application fee.
15 years worth of work history and permission to contact every company you've ever worked for. Number 7, 10 years worth of records from the courts in every county in which you've ever lived. Not just your records, all of them. Every single scrap of court records in every county you've ever lived, including federal, state, and local. All court records for a decade if you waltz through the county for any period of time. Number 6, audited financials. Across the board, audited financials, some certified for owners, affiliates, shareholding companies, board members, and anyone who mentions your company name. Okay, perhaps not that last part. This can cost $10,000, $20,000 or more. Even a startup company is looking at about $5,000 realistically for these audited financials that they require.
Yeah, sometimes the government will have some piece of paper they want from you. And this piece of paper, because you have to have it, the price goes up because the companies know that you have to have it, so they charge a lot of money for it. When I had to build my house, I had to have a site plan was the terminology for it. And, they also want to upsell you for, other things beyond that. It can be costly for these kind of things.
Here's a good one, Mark. Number 5, you must predict the future. For number 5, you're going to need Doc Brown's magic hat. You'll have to provide any contract you're engaged in or any contract you will be engaged in, that being in the future tense.
See, I think that they're getting silly on these things. Obviously, you can only provide the contracts that you might sign in the relatively near future.
Well, yes. You know what they mean, says the article at dinmits.com, but it's still ridiculous. Number 4, paw prints, deeper scoping, and, wait for it, selfies. As if all of the aforementioned crap is not enough, get ready to shell out a few more $1,000 for background checks by licensed PI firms only. Across the board, fingerprints, and you need to include a 2x2-inch selfie. Say cheese. Need a soothing ointment yet? Hold on. It gets worse. Ready for number 3?
I'm ready.
All of this crap for your kiddos, too. Indeed. In fact, go ahead and bring the fam. All beneficiaries are also subject to this intrusive scrutiny and have to supply a good portion of the same information that a principal shareholder does. So if your kid's been bad, be forewarned. You might just find out exactly how bad. So imagine having to give up information about your son to the New York Department of Financial Services just to get their approval to do business.
Yeah, that's disturbing.
Number 2 on this list of 10 things, the secret surety bond. Yes, folks. There's a hidden fee. Shocker there. It's a surety bond that has to be in existence, but here's the swift kick in the groin. They do not tell you how much. This is decided later on and at the discretion of the Department of Financial Services. So be prepared to bribe some officials because it may be the only way in. This is utterly ridiculous. After all is said and done, they can just pronounce a $1 million surety bond on you if they wish, just to prove that you're broke if they haven't forced you into bankruptcy already. So when you're looking at this application, which is ridiculous, 31 pages with all these requirements, you try to figure out, right, when you go through these government legal processes, it's good to know in advance what you're going to be paying. Right, because if you can shoulder it, then maybe you can get through this and you can be semi-free enough to be able to do business. And I'm not just talking about Bitcoin. I'm talking about anything, whether you're applying for an FCC license to broadcast or whatever government permit or license these people are demanding of you to be able to do your business. It's nice to be able to calculate in advance what to expect. Can I even afford to get through this process? Well, in this situation, even if you can afford the $5,000 fee and you can afford the thousands for the private security background checks and all of that, let's say you can afford the $25,000, $30,000, $40,000 that this might cost simply to apply. Well, then after they've gotten through the application, that's when they come back to you and tell you if they need a surety bond, and if so, how much it will cost.
Yeah, and remember what a license is. A license is the government taking away one of your rights and then selling it back to you. In this case, they're selling it rather dearly. But, the government of the state of New York has no business telling you whether or not you can do business in Bitcoin. They have no business doing that. You should survive or fail based on your ability to supply your customers with what they want. I'm not talking about too big to fail here. I'm talking about the government never should have been involved in these banks in the first place. You know, you can blame the financial collapse on deregulation if that's what you want to do, but it wasn't real deregulation. It's crony capitalism deregulation, the kind where, you know, some politicians, to curry favor with donors, remove some unpleasant regulations and then leave the regulations for the little people like us in place.
So the number one thing on the list, kind of a weak one, that is that they don't accept Bitcoin for the application. And so the article goes on to complain that, you know, how dare they not accept Bitcoin for the application fee.
Whatever.
Have they learned anything during this BitLicense process? Oh, yes, they did. They learned how to make it appear as if they're helping the little guys, startups, while making it impossible and out of the reach for any of them. Except Coinbase, of course, being that they still say they're a startup, a $75 million startup, but a startup nonetheless. Even if a startup did manage to scrape through this process, its owners limping along in the aftermath of the grueling spanking of intrusive requirements and financial squeeze, they're still the ultimate veto power of the surety bond. The New York Department of Financial Services examiner of your application might just be in a bad mood the day that he or she reviews your application and just slaps you with a nice fat whopper. With less than perfect credit commanding a 15% payment of the total surety bond, the
$150,000.
The New York Department of Financial Services can just finish you off. That is, if the application process doesn't kick your butt in the first place. Incredible. And you want to talk about a system that will allow for favoritism? Somebody applies, they get the license with a relatively low surety bond, and then their competition, who's not as politically connected, signs up. Oh, all of a sudden, it's a $2 million surety bond for your business. Just arbitrary, according to the bureaucrats. There's no rules, apparently, as to how they get applied. So you know it'll be applied politically favorably. More coming up. It's Free Talk Live.
KatieArmor.com is your one-stop shop for the most affordable body armor, period. With packages starting at $169.99 and free shipping on every order. Katie offers soft armor and rifle threat-rated armor up to level 4. Go to KatieArmor.com and get your body armor today while you still can. Mention this ad and receive a free tactical scarf for a limited time with any body armor package. That's CatiArmor.com. Come and take it.
This is Dan Pilla. Do you owe the IRS money you can't pay? Are tax debts crippling you? I've defended people from the IRS for over 30 years. I've helped thousands, and I can help you too. I wrote the book on IRS settlement, and I'm telling you, there's no such thing as a hopeless case. Call 800-34-NO-TAX to finally get free of IRS debt. With the IRS's new programs, there's never been a better time to solve your problem. Call 800-34-NO-TAX. That's 800-34-NO-TAX or my website, danpilla.com.
Why did you move to the Shire?
I moved here to the Shire because there's other people around who take liberty just as seriously as I do.
I moved to the Shire because I saw videos of people challenging authority and thought that I could get support myself. It called to me, like, do this right now.
I wanted to be around people like me who got it. And once I got here, I knew there was nowhere else that I wanted to be.
I've always wanted to change the world. So I moved to the Shire to join people who were actually working towards doing the same thing.
The people here are awesome, loving, and positive. It was for the adventure and for the feeling of something important is happening here, and I just wanted to come to sort of be part of that.
Visit ShireSociety.com to read and sign the Shire Society Declaration and learn the reasons why, if you love liberty, you should immigrate to the Shire. Plus, add yourself to the Shire map at ShireSociety.com. That's ShireSociety.com.
If you want to play online poker with Bitcoin, you need a site that's trustworthy and technically sound. The site managers of swcpoker.eu have proven their commitment to bringing you great gameplay from a site you can trust, swcpoker.eu. They have lots of new games too, including Chinese poker, and their Krill leaderboard is open right now. It's a beautiful site, easy to use with lots of players. Go on over to swcpoker.eu now and have some fun with your Bitcoin. swcpoker.eu.
Here's a chance to do a little activism while you're cruising Facebook, Twitter, or Google+. Between the LOL cats, the recipes, the hot girls, and the inspirational sunrise memes, Free Talk Live's post pass by your newsfeed. Like them. Comment. It gives us more exposure. If you don't see our posts, click like at facebook.freetalklive.com and then hover over it to click get notifications. It's an easy way to spread the ideas of liberty a bit further. I know you're busy, but you can spare that tenth of a calorie it takes to click on something. Facebook.freetalklive.com.
So the protection of life, liberty, and property is what the Free State Project is all about. But it's an effort to move 20,000 people who understand.
It's about demonstrating to the entire country
that, yeah, we can have a free market, a truly free market.
Making it just a freer, great place to live.
It's the world's largest voluntarist libertarian community, and it's only getting bigger.
That's amazing, to be able to move to a place where other people like passionately believe in being free and independent.
What the Free State Project is managing to do, though, is to put their money where their mouth is. It's physically getting up across the country and saying, let's go someplace and let's demonstrate the power of these ideas. There's a lot of kind of philosophy that surrounds liberty. There's a lot of thinking about it and talking about it. But here in New Hampshire, people are doing it.
101 Reasons Liberty Lives in New Hampshire, a documentary by Free State Project Early Movers. Watch it free at 101reasonsfilm.com. 101reasonsfilm.com.
You're listening to the best liberty-oriented audio streamed around the clock, on the air, and online. This is the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
This is Free Talk Live. What does it take to do business with Bitcoin now if you're in New York State? And to whom does this apply? The story, we're talking about the BitLicense, the story we had shared with you, the 10 most ridiculous requirements in the New York BitLicense application. And the way they make it sound is that this is going to apply to anyone doing any business with Bitcoin. I had originally thought this was only going to apply to people who are doing exchange kind of activities, like Bitcoin exchanges, people who are helping others trade Bitcoin on a marketplace, for instance. But maybe that's not the case. I was digging around, Mark, trying to find out more about who is required to do this. I've still yet to really I looked on the state's website, and of course that's almost impossible to figure anything out from. So if you know more,
that customer service stinks because, yeah, you know, they don't have to provide good customer service.
If you know more about this BitLicense, you want to share it with us, you're welcome to join us, just kind of explaining this on how difficult it is to do business in New York. And it's not just the Bitcoin industry. I mean, anybody that's lived in New York knows the regulations there are oppressive. It is an incredibly unfree place. It is the 50th, the most unfree place in the United States, number 50 out of 50 on the rankings of state economic freedom.
Right. The Mercatus Center's Freedom in the 50 States ranks New York to be the least free state.
Exactly. So we'll tell you a little bit more about why people are leaving New York here. You can share your thoughts toll free at 855-450-FREE. Also, Skype into the show. Username's LRN.FM. It is the live Sunday edition of the program. And if you care about your privacy while you're online, you need ProXPN. It's a virtual private network. They encrypt your online data, which means your internet service provider doesn't know what you're doing anymore once you get with ProXPN. And you can start for free over at proxpn.com, but you're going to need code FTL50 when you get signed up for their premium account to get some unlimited bandwidth, the ability to privately torrent and access websites that you normally couldn't access from where you live. Very handy features. And it's available for Windows, Mac, iOS, Android. Plus, there's Linux support. They offer OpenVPN, which is the gold standard of network encryption. You'll save 50% off the regular monthly price for the lifetime of your account when you buy an annual account with code FTL50. That can mean it's cheaper per month than a good cup of coffee. Go to proxpn.com and use code FTL50. Take back the privacy that is your right. That's code FTL50 at proxpn.com. Let's go to Chris. He is calling from somewhere. You're on Free Talk Live. Hello, Chris.
Hey, good evening, guys. This is Chris from the welfare state of Connecticut.
Oh, all right. Welcome, sir. Go ahead.
Yes, it is a dead zone. At any rate, I had to call in even though I'm working, doing a four-wheel disc job in my truck right now. I just couldn't resist this BitLicense ridiculum that I'm hearing about from you guys right here.
Yeah, tell me about it.
It's pretty typical of New York, and obviously this is going to weed out all but the richest, most connected bunches of people that want to deal in Bitcoin exchanges in the future.
Yep.
You know, you have to have connections to be able to get through this and a lot of money to waste. And it is kind of interesting. A couple months ago on NPR, of all places, I did hear that Goldman Sachs, big New York, Washington bank, is getting involved in Bitcoin through a shell company, basically. They dumped $50 million recently into a startup, like an exchange. So, of course, a bank like Goldman Sachs, who has agents running in and out of Washington and in the presidential administrations, they're easily going to get through this, but it's going to drive out mom and pop like there's no tomorrow.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we're talking
about...
That's
what regulations are about, driving out the little guys so the big guys can do their thing.
Well, we know that, but unfortunately a lot of liberals, if you want to call them that, in this country don't realize that. And I guess neocon Republicans as well, they love the regulation in different aspects also.
Yeah, for whatever reason, people buy the line that politicians, you know, rich, wealthy people that are, doing the bidding of lobbyists or that lobbyists that you didn't pay are somehow doing the work that protects you.
Yeah, they're saving us from ourselves. But obviously, this is just complete totalitarianism. It's disgusting. And those people involved in this, you guys should be proud that you're at the level of like Nazi Germans at this point. You're complete fascists. You're complete scum. And that is, again, Chris from the Welfare State of Connecticut calling in. Just to tell you guys that you guys are scum, New York. I hate you, and I'll never spend a dime there in your state again. Take care, guys. Good
thanks for the passion, Chris. I appreciate hearing from you. And hopefully New Hampshire will serve as the counter example to New York. Of course, here in New Hampshire, we've got a lively Bitcoin universe, if you will. There are a lot of Bitcoin entrepreneurs that are here. The guys who created the Lamassu Bitcoin vending machine are based in Manchester. There are businesses across the state who are accepting Bitcoin. There's a corner news store right here on Main Street in Keene. There's even now a Main Street store in a nearby town that's accepting it. So little mom and pop businesses are taking it, and we're seeing a lot of the Bitcoin, some of the Bitcoin movers and shakers are actually here in New Hampshire. So we've seen proposals just in the last year. There was a proposal, it didn't go through, but it's, I think, going to a study committee, if I'm recalling correctly. There was one proposal to have the state of New Hampshire officially begin to accept Bitcoin for taxes and fees. So, you know, if that actually were to happen...
It'd be unusual.
It would be something that, in some people's eyes, would legitimize Bitcoin. Now, there's an argument against it, like, well, you know, we don't want the state to accept Bitcoin, that'll somehow ruin Bitcoin. I don't think that's a very strong argument. I think that I actually testified in favor of this particular piece of legislation. Our own Daryl W. Perry was the only person who testified against it. But overall, the Bitcoin community seemed very supportive of the idea of New Hampshire's government officially accepting Bitcoin. And that would be a big change for them, which one of the reasons to oppose it would be that there could be costs involved in that transition, right, to whatever the bureaucracy would have to do to accept Bitcoin.
It increases the size of government bureaucracy.
It could involve costs, but there was one company that came in that said that they would be willing, like a payment processor, kind of like one of the BitPays or the Coinbases. There was actually one that's based here in New Hampshire, I think called ZifterCoin, if I recall, or maybe ZiftPay or ZifterPay or something. Anyway, they came in and said, look, if you choose us as your payment processor, we'll come in, we'll do all this, we'll do the training, we'll do it all for free. So they made it look like there would be next to zero cost.
It seems like more options on how to pay is better for the people that are paying, whether they, you know, whether you ask for these services or not.
And, you know, part of the interesting part about this process, Mark, is the learning curve that these politicians will have to go through in order to even grasp what Bitcoin is, in order to be able to vote on this thing. Now, again, I think it was sent to a study committee, if I'm recalling correctly. Please correct me if I'm wrong on this. But it was interesting watching the hearings. I was there for these things. There was recordings of them. You go and search freekeen.com for, like, Bitcoin hearing or something like Bitcoin in Concord, maybe. Those will come up. And it was interesting, the chairman of what was essentially the banking committee, so they've got the state house, each committee has different members on it, and so there's the banking commerce committee.
Sure.
This guy kept calling it BitCon. Like, even though he'd been corrected a number of times throughout the long, hours-long hearing, he kept
was doing it on purpose?
No, I don't think it was on purpose. I think he's just, you know, an older guy, and he just kept
can't
saying
figure it out.
BitCon, you know, maybe he just didn't see the I or something like that in the word. So,
well, I mean, BitCon could certainly be an insulting thing to call Bitcoin, right?
Yeah, I see where you're coming from there. It seemed like a genuine mistake, Mark, but you may be right. Maybe it was a real
so
subtle
he was
jab.
Corrected several times and just kept calling it a con over and over again.
Yeah, it seemed genuine to me. I don't feel like he all was right. jabbing, but you know,
whatever.
You could be right about that. Anyway, it's interesting to watch them, and some of them have a genuine interest, you know. Some of them are already involved in Bitcoin here in New Hampshire. We actually have state representatives who accept Bitcoin
sure.
and who are interested in Bitcoin. I don't know if that's true in New York State. I doubt it.
I can't imagine.
Yeah.
Maybe.
And so I think that, you know, I hope that New Hampshire becomes this shining beacon of Bitcoin liberty compared to New York, because
I'd love to
then
see
we
that
can attract
too.
Businesses here that are Bitcoin friendly.
I'd love to see that too, but I mean, New Hampshire doesn't even have cities with the highest use of Bitcoin. I mean, there's places all around the world that
actually,
have
actually, Mark, if you look at the list of, there was like a top 10 that came out several months ago. About what are the most like concentrated Bitcoin using cities? What cities have the most places you can go per capita to use Bitcoin? And how many have the Bitcoin vending machines and ATMs? San Francisco was listed as number one on that list, but when I did the math, Keene beat San Francisco. There's more coming up here in moments, and you can join us here with your thoughts at 855-450-FREE. This is Free Talk Live.
Every once in a while, you get information that's worth changing your life for. This is one such time. You can save up to and beyond 25% on all purchases at Amazon. You probably heard of Bitcoin and just not thought much about it. You certainly know that you can get competitive pricing at Amazon, but now you can get a 25% discount on nearly everything you need to live. I've just given you a huge raise, and all you have to do is claim it. You go to purse.freetalklive.com and open an account. Do this right now, don't wait. Then you fund the account with Bitcoin. You can buy them through expresscoin.com with a check or money order. There are other ways to get Bitcoin, but that's fast, safe, and easy. This information is worth you changing the way you do things. Go to purse.freetalklive.com right now and get signed up and cash in on the huge raise I'm offering you. 25% off of everything on Amazon through purse.freetalklive.com. It's purse.freetalklive.com.
We are a survival company. We manufacture our own line of Level 3 and Level 3A body armor. We proudly make our armor 100% in America. We have the best prices in the nation, about $125 cheaper than our nearest competitor. All lab certified, for thou art my rock and my fortress, Psalm 31:3. We are Fortress Survival LLC.com.
Everyone says or does something silly once in a while. But once that embarrassing thing is on the internet, it can spread like a terrible rash. Put it to rest. Get a free expert analysis today from Reputation.com. It only takes 30 seconds. 800-831-0771. We protect your online image by helping to make sure that when people search for you or your business, they find the most current, accurate information possible. Reputation.com. Because word travels fast. Call for a free analysis today. 800-831-0771. That's 800-831-0771.
Keenvention is coming up October 30th through November 1st. Get your tickets now at keenvention.info. Keenvention is your chance to meet dozens of key liberty activists from across the Shire. Explore Keene, discuss various forms of activism with seasoned veterans, do some Robin Hooding, and learn about making the move. Visit keenvention.info for full video coverage of every speaker and panel from 2013 on. This year, Activist of the Year Daryl W. Perry and Chris Cantwell will be keynoting. Join old and new friends and neighbors in Keene for Keenevention this October 30th through November 1st. Only 100 tickets are available in advance, so lock yours in now for just $60 or pay with Bitcoin. That includes access to the Hallow Keene Costume Dance Party. Reserve your tickets now at keenevention.info. Visit keenevention.info for more speaker announcements or look for our page and event on Facebook. That's keenevention.info. Keenevention.info. So you've heard all 3 hours of the latest episode of Free Talk Live, and you're still hungry for liberty-oriented audio content? Did you know that we have another 24/7 audio stream at lrn.fm? The Liberty Radio Network airs the latest episodes of some of the best liberty-oriented podcasts on the internet, around the clock. In addition to recorded content, you'll also hear live shows like Free Talk Live, originating from our Keene, New Hampshire studio. So listen anytime at lrn.fm. That's lrn.fm.
If you have a business, you know that IT can be frustrating, but it doesn't have to be. IT can serve your needs reliably, predictably, and on time. Rootwork Infotech helps businesses achieve always-on reliability. Their nerds know business and can meet your needs. To prove it, they'll give you 30 minutes on the phone with a senior consultant for free to answer any of your IT questions. Just go to rootwork.it/FTL to get your free call. That's rootwork.it/FTL.
While our satellite channel is free to listen to, it's not free for us. You can help us cover our satellite costs with a chip-in on the right side of the page at lrn.fm.
This is Free Talk Live. You're invited to join us on the radio waves toll-free. 855-450-FREE is the number. That's 855-450-3733. Join us on Skype. The Skype username is lrn.fm. And if you want to help support Free Talk Live, you like what we're doing here on the airwaves every night, 7 nights a week live, you can get behind the show by becoming an amplifier at amp.freetalklive.com. amp.freetalklive.com. You go there, get signed up with any major credit card, through PayPal, or you can use Visa or MasterCard there, and it's $5 a month. We'll take that money in and invest it into Free Talk Live, getting on more radio stations. We've got over 150. We could be on 300. It's possible. You just need more money to do the marketing of the
show. It's really just about that.
So there's that, and then there's also we can get on more internet connections by doing internet outreach and spread our satellite signal as well. So go and learn more at AMP. And get signed up, get the perks. amp.freetalklive.com. amp.freetalklive.com. Eric is in Ohio. Coming up, we'll talk about the real cost of applying for one of these bit licenses in New York. Eric, you're on Free Talk Live with Ian and Mark.
How's it going, guys?
Hi, Eric. You're on the air. Go ahead.
I just wanted to touch on something. I'd seen a Facebook group that was I can't remember the name exactly, but it was in reference to Uber. I'd seen one of the posts they were advocating at first, you know, free market principles against the cabs, you know, ganging up to try and regulate Uber. So I started following the page. As time went on, they started to advocating for the option to add a tip in the app, which I was fine with. You know, advocating for that is fine. But then they started recommending to drivers to, if someone doesn't tip you, to give them a 1-star rating, and eventually you won't get picked up.
It was my understanding that with Uber, tipping was not required.
Yeah, but the drivers give a rating to people, right?
Yeah, they give a rating. They were comparing it to Lyft. Lyft has an option in the app to tip the driver.
Mm-hmm.
And they were, you know, they laid out their math, and you're saying, you know, it's not worth it. We're not making enough money. You know, add a tip option. Uber addressed it and said, no, there's no need to tip. So their way of combating that was any rider that does not tip you, give them a 1-star rating. So
I'm confused. I thought there is no way to tip in the Uber app. Did they add that or did they not?
Ian, they didn't add it.
They did not.
And
so how are you supposed to tip the driver?
This Facebook group is advocating that if somebody doesn't tip beyond what the app says,
but you can't tip.
Yes, you can. You can hand money from your hand to the driver.
Well, but normally with Uber, you're paying with the app. You're paying with a credit card.
But they want you to come out of your pocket with money and give it to the driver. And if you don't, they advocate that the driver give you a 1-star rating in order to make sure that no other driver wants to pick you up in the future.
Isn't the way to fight that to give the driver a 1-star rating if he rates you 1-star?
You don't see your own Uber rating, so you won't know if you're rated lower.
So has this actually been happening, or is this just a thread on the internet that people are speculating and saying they're going to do it?
There were people that claimed to be drivers that were commenting and saying that they were doing it. I saw an article the other day, but it was actually a very large publication, and it addressed that point, you know, why you might not have a perfect rating and why, you know, you might not be getting Uber rides is because the drivers are giving you one star because you didn't pull cash out of your pocket.
So wait, with Uber, you can't even see your total star rating, or you can't see individual ratings given by drivers?
It's difficult to see your cumulative rating. You have to, you basically have to request it from them.
Huh. Wow.
You can't just go to a profile and see it.
I don't know how widespread this is going to end up, right? I mean, this may be just a minority of Uber drivers who are the kind of people who are trying to organize Uber into,
well, they're
like,
also never going to get you as a passenger again at that point because you're a one-star rating. They won't even necessarily know who you are. Like, they're kind of messing up the system to their own detriment. Now, some of them are likely to be cycling out because they're not happy with the pay they're getting, but where are they going to go?
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I wouldn't be too worried about this unless people start having experiences trying to use the app but being unable to get a driver to actually pick them up and then wondering why that is.
This is really more of Uber's problem than the riders.
It just, you know, it feels to me like your standard Uber driver is not going to be expecting a tip, because that's sort of the rules with Uber, is that you're not supposed to tip the driver. There's no mechanism for that. And you know, the drivers are making what, 80%, I think?
80%, yeah.
Yeah, so I just feel like this is just some uppity Uber drivers on the internet, and this isn't going to turn into anything big. But it is worth, I think, mentioning. And Eric, anything else you want to share tonight?
Well, I was just going to say, I've asked a few of the drivers I've had, and none of them have heard of it, except for one, and he said he thought it was ridiculous. He said he made good money. You know, he's not sitting in a suburb on, you know, a Sunday afternoon.
There's a certain portion of Uber drivers, we've read stories about this on the air, there's a certain portion of them, and I don't know what you know, 5% or something like that, there's not very many of them, I suspect, that they want to organize Uber drivers into some kind of a union. They want to turn Uber into an employer instead of an independent contract organization, which is the current deal that the drivers have, is you're an independent contractor, you work at your pleasure, you log into the app when you're wanting to go to work, we don't tell you when to show up like we would tell an employee, you're not using company cars, you're using your own car as an independent contractor would do, they would use their own tools and their own equipment in a lot of cases. And so there are people who want to change that completely about Uber, and I suspect that those people will always be in the minority, because Uber is likely to – I think Uber is sort of the business model they have – is likely to encourage the entrepreneurial types, the kind of people who want the idea of getting away from a job, the kind of people who value the idea of being able to set their own hours and to sculpt their own working world in that way. That's the kind of person that's going to be attracted to a job like that. But, of course, there's going to be a very small minority who are talking about how it ought to be completely different, and I don't think they're going to get any traction. Eric, thanks for the call tonight, but time will tell, I suppose, and we'll let you know if we hear something else.
Yeah, I can see why people are upset. Sometimes you make less than minimum wage doing Uber.
Sometimes you make more.
Sometimes you make more. And it can, you know, it's frustrating being your own boss and taking care of your own insurance costs.
You gotta clean your own car out.
Yeah, all these things. There's no doubt about it. And I don't think anybody's getting rich doing Uber, but at the same time, you're deciding when you want to work and when you don't.
That's worth a lot. I mean, for a lot of people, to be able to set your own hours, that's a huge benefit.
For a lot of people, having a job is a big deal now. And, you know, if you can work out with somebody to give them rides and get money for it, that beats the alternative.
Yeah, and with Uber, and I presume Lyft as well, but I know that with Uber, they have the rush pricing or whatever they call it. There's different pricing based on how busy things are. So if there's a high demand in the Uber client for people to get rides, then the people who are offering rides will be giving more money. Uber will make you agree
if you're a passenger during one of these rush times, or they call, there's some other term, I'm not using the right word, but if you're a passenger during one of these times, it confirms with you when you set up for your ride, when you request the ride, it confirms with you, hey, you understand, right, that you're going to get charged twice the normal rates for this ride, and you have to, like, initial that you have read this or you understand that, because there have been some people who've complained saying, well, I thought I was going to get the same rates I normally do, but you charged me three times as much. Well, that's because there were three times the demand in the market, and we needed to raise the price.
And we let you know.
Yeah, and we told you about that. So if you're a driver and you really want to make some money, you get out and you drive during those times, right? Whenever it is that there's a, let's say there's a convention in town, there's a bunch of people taking cabs in a one area or something like that, that might be a good time to go out and go to work. And, you know, even if that means getting out of bed in the middle of the night, if you know there's a certain time when there's going to be few drivers on the road and a high demand. I don't know. You'd have to be, you know, connected with what's going on around you, right? If you knew that there was like some, let's say one of those, there's like a video game convention called PAX East that happens in Boston, I think, or on the East Coast somewhere. There's another one on the West. There's like 50,000 people that attend a convention that size. You don't think people are taking cabs with that? Yeah, you better believe it. So that might be a good time to do it. Or just maybe a Friday night or a Saturday night in general. But I guess it would also depend on how many drivers are out at that time too. So if more drivers get on the road, then the price will come down.
You probably don't even have to get on the road. You can probably just sit at your house and wait for somebody to call for a ride.
Yeah, that's certainly true. If you're close to downtown.
Depending on where you are, if you're in the, you know, you can always wait.
It's an interesting thing, I got to say. And kudos to those people who are making it happen and the folks over at Uber. I don't agree with all their corporate policies, but that's just how it is. 855-450-FREE. That is our toll-free number, 855-450-3733. Parenthood. Is it worse than unemployment and divorce, even the death of a partner? That's all coming up on Free Talk Live. Hours 3 is on the way.
Are you searching for your soulmate? Someone you can trust, who will never betray you or cooperate with the NSA? Stop searching. With EasyDNS, you found a keeper. EasyDNS does it all. Domain names, web hosting, and managed WordPress hosting. EasyDNS stands up for your internet freedom. And with servers in Canada, they do not cooperate with the NSA. Go to EasyDNS.com. You'll love their services or get a full refund. They guarantee it. And they accept Bitcoin. That's EasyDNS.com.
Geico applauds your inner road name.
A slow clap goes out to your biker alter ego. You might be mild-mannered Michael in the office, the guy known for raising his hand in meetings, but out on the open road, it's Motor Mike. Geico supports you and your bike, Motor Mike, because beyond cars, Geico insures motorcycles, those glorious vroom vroom machines. With 24/7 customer service and great rates, the only thing you'll be raising from now on is a heck of a good time. So head out on the highway and make that road yours, Mike. Make it yours.
Geico Motorcycle. See how much you could save.
This is your Robertson Roberts Brokerage Daily Precious Metals Update. In early trading Friday, gold is $3 higher at $1,119 per ounce. Silver is up 7 cents at $15.57 per ounce. Bitcoin is trading at $265. With oil and other commodities sinking, seeing rising prices in gold and silver is very encouraging for precious metals. For more information, give us a call, 800-874-9760, or visit our website at rrbi.co.
LRN.fm is proud to announce our official listening apps for Android and iOS devices. Now you can easily tune into our streams anywhere, anytime on your smartphone or tablet. Just visit apps.lrn.fm or search for LRN.fm in the Android or Apple app stores. Please download, rate it 5 stars, then share the link on social media, and let your friends and family know how you're listening to LRN.fm. Download it now, free at apps.lrn.fm. That's apps.lrn.fm.
You're listening to the live edition of Free Talk Live. Hour number 3 is next after the news here on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.fm.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Sunday, August 16th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.26 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,115 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $261. Antiwar.com reports several months into the Saudi Arabia-led war against Yemen's Shiite Houthis, the pro-Saudi faction, the former government led by Abd Rabu Mansour Hadi, has gained a little bit of territory around Aden, and that has raised international calls for some sort of settlement leading to elections. That's not seemingly likely, however, with Hadi government officials still talking up a full-scale military victory nationwide after having taken one city and some nearby towns. The group's ambassador to the UN says victory is assured. Ambassador Ali Mani said of the Houthis, "They are on the run," adding, "My feelings is this is going to be weeks before we can liberate the entire country from the coup." Regional diplomats aren't nearly so optimistic and are urging the two sides to talk and settle things. Hadi was a military leader elected in a single-candidate vote in 2013 after the Arab Spring resignation of longtime dictator Ali Abdullah Saleh. Hadi resigned himself in January after an offensive against the Houthis turned sour and the Houthis took over the capital. The UN already brokered one round of peace talks in Switzerland, but it failed when the two sides would not meet in the same room. The only time they were together turned ugly when Hadi envoys attacked a Houthi spokesman at a press conference. Bitcoin Not Bombs is a launching pad for nonprofits and social entrepreneurs into the financial freedom of the Bitcoin economy. Bitcoin Not Bombs is fully committed to being the hub of the nonprofit sector of the Bitcoin economy. To learn more, visit BitcoinNotBombs.com. UPI reports flights in airspace along the East Coast were disrupted for hours on Saturday due to a technical glitch at the Federal Aviation Administration's Northern Virginia Control Center. Officials said the glitch occurred in an automated system at the agency's Air Traffic Control Center in Leesburg, Virginia, affecting flights leaving and arriving at multiple airports in the New York City and Washington, D.C. areas. As those airports are responsible for a great share of the East Coast air traffic, the glitch caused cancellations, delays, and reroutes, according to the FAA. Just after 2 p.m. Eastern Time on Saturday, the agency said the system was back online. The New York City area airports operate traffic for some of the most congested airspace in the world. The FAA did not specify exactly how many flights were disrupted, but it did say the glitch was not a result of a security breach.
For over 35 years, Robertson Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Robertson Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
Reuters reports telecommunication powerhouse AT&T has provided extensive assistance to the U.S. National Security Agency as the spy agency conducts surveillance on huge volumes of internet traffic passing through the United States. The New York Times reported on Saturday, citing newly disclosed NSA documents, that the company gave technical assistance to the NSA in carrying out a secret court order allowing wiretapping of all internet communications at the headquarters of the United Nations, which is an AT&T customer. The documents date from between 2003 and 2013 and were provided by fugitive former NSA contractor Edward Snowden. The documents describe how the NSA's working relationship with AT&T had been particularly important, enabling the agency to conduct surveillance under various legal rules of international and foreign-to-foreign internet communications that pass through network hubs in the United States. According to one NSA document describing the link between the agency and the company, this is a partnership, not a contractual relationship. According to another NSA document, AT&T's corporate relationships provide unique access to other telecoms and internet service providers. AT&T started in 2011 to provide the NSA more than 1.1 billion domestic cell phone calling records daily after a push to get this flow operational prior to the 10th anniversary of 9/11, referring to the September 11th, 2001 attacks on the United States. This has been FPP Radio News, online at fppradio.com.
An alarming new study finds that people suffering from stress-related disorders react poorly to being trapped in underwater elevators. A tired 398-month-old throws a tantrum, and a little clay thing is purchased at an arts festival. And now, an eerily perfect recap of this week's news. The Catholic Church reversed its long-held stance against gay marriage this week after meeting Connecticut couple Tony and Craig. The vacationing pair dazzled the Pope and assorted clergy with their witty conversation and true loving affection for each other, leading Vatican officials to conclude that love is love and it's silly to put restrictions on it in this day and age. The Chinese people announced that they would be willing to forgive most of the United States' $1.16 trillion debt if Americans agreed to dress up in costumes and perform silly dances for them. Chinese officials encouraged U.S. citizens to wear sequined vests and prance around while slapping their big fat American tummies, promising that the more humiliating the performance, the more debt will be erased. In sports, NASCAR fans are deeply puzzled by a mysterious black family seen attending multiple races.
This is the Onion News Network.
This is Free Talk Live. Join us. Toll-free number 855-450-FREE. Live Sunday edition continuing here. It's Ian.
And Mark.
And that number 855-450-FREE. And also Skype username lrn.fm. Parenthood. Is it worse than divorce? Unemployment? Even the death of a partner? Mark, you've got a 7-year-old son, and you say what most parents seem to say about their children, and that he's the best thing that's ever happened to you.
Yeah. I mean, there's nothing like it. Of course, your life changes completely.
But if it's the best thing that ever happened, how could this headline be even possible?
Well, it could be written by somebody who just thinks that children are terrible. Maybe they've got an axe to grind. I'd like to hear what they have to say. Because I can tell you that there are a lot of people in this world, and I'm guessing their parents have put a great deal of pressure on them. This didn't happen to me. But, you know, it's like, Mom, I'm not going to have kids, and I don't care what you say. Mm. And they'll just act out around this. And ladies and gentlemen, the conversation that you need to have with your parents should not be had in sort of the public sphere, would be what I'd have to say regarding that.
From the Washington Post, Ariana Cha, published just a few days ago. Life has its ups and downs, but parenthood is supposed to be among the most joyous. At least that's what the movies and Target ads tell us. In reality, it turns out that having a child can have a pretty strong negative impact on a person's happiness, according to a new study published in the journal Demography. In fact, on average, the effect of a new baby on a person's life in the first year is devastatingly bad, worse than divorce, unemployment, and even the death of a partner.
So the effect on their life. See, I don't know what that means. It's the interpretation of the effect that really ultimately matters, right?
Sure.
I mean, you can
have...
And that's
all they're asking people is, you know, how do you feel about this?
Right, and you can have a terrible thing happen to you, and if you interpret that terrible thing as a good thing, then it's a good thing that happened.
Yeah, so, that's absolutely true. It is about your attitude.
I
didn't have a bad time when I was in jail. I went in with a positive attitude about
it. Good for you, buddy.
After doing civil disobedience.
But a kid, of course, is much more life-changing than going to jail for a couple of months or whatever.
It depends on who you talk, you know, who you ask. I mean, somebody going to jail could really have their life screwed up, right? If they can't get a job after that, for instance, or have a tough time getting it.
Having spent 8.5 years in prison myself, I'm going to say that having the kid was more life-changing.
Okay.
Or at least sort of had longer effects. When you're out of prison, you're out. You can change things, do whatever you want.
Mm-hmm.
So, I think it's more about the parents' interpretation. Plenty of people have, you know, psychological issues once they have kids. You know, it's a hormone change. So I'm interested in hearing what they have to say.
Researchers Rachel Margolis and Miko Mirskyla followed 2016 of them, actually, Germans, who were childless at the time the study began until at least 2 years after the birth of their first child. Respondents were asked to rate their happiness from 0, that is completely dissatisfied, to 10, completely satisfied, in response to the question, how satisfied are you with your life, all things considered? They wrote, quote, although this measure does not capture respondents' overall experience of having a child, it's preferable to direct questions about childbearing because it's considered taboo for new parents to say negative things about a new child, they wrote.
Okay, one thing about the satisfaction. I think I don't like the phrasing of the question. yes, it's true. I am not satisfied now because I'm wishing to sort of be more successful so I can create a better world for my child and so that they can have better education. That does not mean that my child makes me unhappy. It just means that my threshold for satisfaction may have moved up because now I have a child. Does that make sense?
I see where you're coming from. The study's goal was to try to gain insights into a long-standing contradiction in fertility in many developed countries between how many children people say they want and how many they actually have. In Germany, most couples say in surveys that they want two children. Yet the birth rate in the country has remained stubbornly low at 1.5 children per woman for 40 years. Margolis, a society researcher, a sociology researcher.
I suspect people have as many children as they want once they're above a certain age, right?
Yeah.
And the people below that age are probably having more children than they want.
A sociology researcher at the University of Western Ontario found that most couples in the study started out pretty happy when they set out to have their first child. In the year prior to the birth, their satisfaction ticked up even more, perhaps due to the pregnancy and the anticipation of the baby.
I would suspect that's it. I mean, they're sort of living into the future and everything's going to be great.
It was only after birth that the parents' experiences diverged. About 30% remained at about the same state of happiness, or better, once they had the baby, according to self-reported measures of well-being. The rest said their happiness decreased during the first and second year after the birth. Those mothers and fathers whose happiness went down, 37% reported a one-unit drop, 19%.
Did they claim, hold on, was it, this was the satisfaction questions? Or, because I don't like the idea that we switched from are you satisfied to are you happy. Is that, has that what's occurred here?
I'm not clear on that.
Well, they asked the question about satisfaction, and then they're interpreting that satisfaction to be, that satisfaction or lack of satisfaction to be happiness. And that's not the same thing. This is, you see, once again, axe grinding, right? Like the people who don't have kids need to justify to themselves that, hey, my life's going great. I don't need kids. Ladies and gentlemen, if that's how you feel, you don't care. Like, don't have kids. If you don't want kids, don't have them. And I would say you need to think about whether you want to have kids or not. You really need to be clear as to whether or not you want to have kids. If the reason you're saying to yourself, you know what, this will really make my parents happy, it's a bad idea.
Yeah, bad idea.
Let them go adopt kids.
So apparently there seems to be some sort of a happiness scale here that has points on it. And 37% of the mothers and fathers whose happiness went down, 37% of them reported a one-unit drop, 19% a two-unit, and 17% a three-unit drop. On average, new parenthood led to a 1.4-unit drop in happiness, and that is considered to be very severe in this study. To put things in perspective, previous studies have quantified the impact of other major life events on the same happiness scale in this way. Divorce is the equivalent of a 0.6 on the happiness unit drop. Unemployment is a 1-unit drop, and the death of a partner also a 1-unit drop. So that's how they get the conclusion that having a child is leading people to be less happy than being unemployed, the death of a partner, and even divorce as well.
I guess I just can't accept this. I don't.
2,000 people. That's a fairly large study.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I hear lots of things being said. I don't like the questions as they were asked. It's also Germany, which makes me feel sort of divorced from the results. There's the old joke: if something weird in the world happens, it happens in Florida or Germany, right? And I don't know how to address that in my mind. It's just, I'm looking at my life. I was happy before I had my son. I'm happy now. Yeah, there's some issues with sleep, but...
Well, about 30% were at the same state of happiness or better. So you would have been, if you were a respondent of this survey, presumably you'd have been in that 30%, the one-third of people
But they're saying that this is worse than the death of a close family member, and I just can't accept that, Ian. Like, this really, really sounds like the two... What were the authors' names of this again? Margarita and whatever her name were, really just don't want to have kids is what it sounds like to me.
Or maybe they already have had kids and they regret it.
Maybe they do.
The data showed that the larger the loss in well-being, the lower the likelihood of a second baby. The effect was especially strong in mothers and fathers who are older than age 30 and with a higher education. So maybe they originally had wanted two children, and then they got one and found out that it wasn't what it was cracked up to be, and decided to forget about the idea of having a second.
Yeah,
one.
I don't know how to address that either. I wasn't really interested in having children early on. My wife wanted
you
to
only
have,
want one though, right?
My wife wanted to have kids. And so, you know, I was at zero.
Yeah.
She's like at, well, just one, right? Like, so she's negotiating from zero to one. You can't have a half a kid. And so, you know, there was never a conversation to be had about a second kid. Oh yeah, let's have two. No, I don't want two.
Yeah, I thought you had an agreement in place that it was going to just be the one.
I don't know that we had an agreement specifically for just one, but it certainly, you know, I mean, I wasn't intending to have more than one.
You got a vasectomy, so that's going to put a dampener
on. She can have
on.
Kids, but it's not going to be from me.
There's more on the way here. You can join us. 855-450-FREE. Was having kids good for your life?
Every once in a while, you get information that's worth changing your life for. This is one such time. You can save up to and beyond 25% on all purchases at Amazon. You probably heard of Bitcoin and just not thought much about it. You certainly know that you can get competitive pricing at Amazon, but now you can get a 25% discount on nearly everything you need to live. I've just given you a huge raise, and all you have to do is claim it. You go to purse.freetalklive.com and open an account. Do this right now, don't wait. Then you fund the account with Bitcoin. You can buy them through expresscoin.com with a check or money order. There are other ways to get Bitcoin, but that's fast, safe, and easy. This information is worth you changing the way you do things. Go to purse.freetalklive.com right now and get signed up and cash in on the huge raise I'm offering you. 25% off of everything on Amazon through purse.freetalklive.com. It's purse.freetalklive.com.
It's time to build your own emergency food stockpile with the industry leader, My Patriot Supply. Once you try them, you'll know why so many Americans like you have made them part of their emergency preparedness plan. Experience the My Patriot Supply difference today with this unbelievable offer. Right now, a four-week food supply is only $99, and that includes free shipping. That's 50% off the online price. Call 800-274-3070 to claim yours. Limit two per caller while supplies last. This offer isn't available online, so you want to make sure and grab this opportunity to get prepared today. 800-274-3070 to get your four-week food supply for the incredible price of only $99, and it'll be shipped to you completely free. Call 800-274-3070 right now. That's 800-274-3070 to claim yours while supplies last. Don't wait. Call today.
If you're looking for work, it's a process of elimination, and you're trying not to be eliminated. So here's a tip for making the cut, and this might seem subtle, but to the person interviewing you, it's not. There is a world of difference between applicants who convey, "I need a job," and those who simply ooze, "I want to work," especially in these lean times when many you're competing with will seem desperate in "I'll take anything" mode. If you convey specific interest in this job at this company, you will be conspicuous. Thus, the value of going to school on the company you're applying to before the interview. With money and attention so tight now, effective communication skills have never been more important. For more tips for job seekers and everyone else, hit survivalspeech.com. I'm Holland Cook.
Free Talk Live has partnered with Amazon, the largest internet retailer. Imagine a department store category, and Amazon has it. Books, electronics, office products, furniture, jewelry, automotive, toys, clothing, sporting goods, and dozens of other categories. Now you can shop and support Free Talk Live by entering Amazon through our website. Go to shop.freetalklive.com, and Amazon will send us a portion of your purchase. You're going to do the shopping anyway, so remember to enter through our site at shop.freetalklive.com. That's shop.freetalklive.com.
My name is Jacob Hornberger. I'm president of the Future of Freedom Foundation, which Congressman Ron Paul awarded for having an outstanding freedom website. Write us at fff@fff.org, and we'll send you a free 3-month subscription to our monthly journal of libertarian essays and our booklet, Economic Liberty in the Constitution, which George Mason University economics professor Walter Williams praised in a recent column. That's fff@fff.org.
Do you love Twitter? Make sure you favorite the LRN.FM Twitter account so you can receive our tweets at twitter.lrn.fm. That's twitter.lrn.fm.
Free Talk Live's live Sunday edition, the toll-free number here for you to join us, 855-450-FREE. Is this study from Germany onto something? Is having a child really worse than divorce, unemployment, or the death of a partner? Because that's what the study from Germany that looked at over 2,000 people, they followed 2,000 people who were childless at the time the study began until at least 2 years after the birth of their first child. The respondents were asked the question, how satisfied are you with your life, all things considered? Now, it's a very general, open answer kind of question, and I think that's probably the biggest hole in the study, is that they aren't asking specifically about the children. But on the other hand, they do point out that if you ask people about children, there's sort of a societal pressure to say only nice things about your experience with your child.
Right. I would agree with that, that it's very difficult to sort of find out how people's lives have been enhanced by having kids, and if they've been enhanced by having kids. I'd go so far as to say that, look, there are a lot of unqualified people having children out there. That has to result in sort of bad, upsetting things for them. I also believe that, you should not have children if you do not feel like it's a good idea for you. You shouldn't allow the pressure that comes from, you know, family members and these sorts of things to make you do something you don't want to do. Now, if you're in a relationship with a partner who wants to have kids and you don't, clearly you're at an impasse. You have to make a decision, like, my wife and I had to make a decision in our lives. We had to decide, like, she wanted to have kids. I'm like, things are really just fine in my life. I don't need a kid. These are contrary positions. So we had to come to an agreement. We did. We had a kid. And I'm sort of said, well, you've got to take care of him. And she did. And she's done a really great job. And that's fine. And he's an enhancement to my life.
There are people who hold sort of two what seem like contradictory positions. There's a person I've known people who have said things like, well, I love my son, he's the greatest thing that ever happened to me, but I wish I never had him. they can hold that position simultaneously. Like, they're glad they've had this experience to some extent, like it's been an enriching, enjoyable experience in its own way, but on the other hand, they wish they didn't have to have that responsibility in life, that they could have just, you know, gone in a different direction. They could have started a business that they maybe always dreamed of starting had they not had the child when they had the child. Maybe they would have wanted the child, but 20 years later or something like that. So it is possible, I think, to hold sort of semi or seemingly contradictory positions about having a child.
I guess, you can certainly love somebody and it can be inconvenient, especially if they... they're needy, right?
Sure.
I mean, kids are needy and they're going to continue to be needy. They, as a matter of fact, are going to feel entitled far longer than they are in fact needy. So for instance, when you're talking about a 18, 19, 20 year old living in your basement, mm-hmm.
They don't need to live there.
If it just comes down to giving you guilt and not having to pay rent, well, you know, like it's a lot easier to have a conversation with your parent and make them feel guilty than it is to pay rent.
The consequence of negative experiences, this is according to the Washington Post, was that many of the parents stopped having children after the first one. And the data showed the larger the loss in well-being, the lower the likelihood of a second baby. The effect was especially strong in mothers and fathers who are older than age 30 and with a higher education. Surprisingly, gender was not a factor. The researchers wrote, quote, fertility is a choice for most people in the developed world. If the transition to parenthood is very difficult or more difficult than expected, then people may choose to remain at parity. The researchers wrote that challenges of new parents that impacted their decision to have another child fell into three categories. The first two had to do with their health. Mothers reported physical pain and nausea conflicted with their desire to work. Fathers expressed concern about the medical issues of their partner. And second, complications during the birth also appeared to shape their decision to not go through it again.
I would say that I was in the room when my wife had her child. We did the sort of natural childbirth thing. Mm-hmm. She did the natural childbirth thing. I sort of experienced
it.
I experienced things. And I'd say it's one of the most traumatic experiences of my life.
Wow. Of your life, and you weren't going through it.
Right. I mean, I'm just seeing what's going on.
What would
right?
she say, though?
Oh, she
would she say it was one of the most wonderful experiences of her life?
Well, having a child. Some women really enjoy childbirth.
They do, yeah.
I would not say that she's in that camp necessarily, but she was sort of in a trance, as it were. And I'm, you know, making a decision whether or not to call an ambulance because the heart rate's going down, these kind of things.
So she was in a trance, but not on drugs.
No, she'd taken these meditation courses and that.
Okay.
And she's also getting really sort of contrary feedback. We're saying everything's fine. Everything's fine. Uh-huh. What we really needed to say is like, look, the child's heart rate's going down. You need to push. And when we finally said that, that's when that everything happened.
Huh.
Yeah.
The third category was the most significant and was about the continuous and intense nature of child rearing. These are the things that are dissuading first-time parents from being second-time. Parents reported exhaustion due to trouble breastfeeding, sleep deprivation, depression, domestic isolation, and relationship breakdown. The findings,
I believe all those things, yeah.
Yeah. So the findings are likely to be eye-opening for some policymakers who are concerned about low fertility rates in their countries and suggest, and I don't agree with this, that government should consider giving additional support to new parents. That's what you need. More subsidies. That'll make everything better.
Yeah, I can see why people say, look, I need 6 months here. Male, female, you know.
You mean like after the birth kind of thing?
Yeah, I can totally see why people say that. I mean, you know, I think it's a fair number and maybe it's longer than that. But we made a decision in my family that, you know, she was going to stay home and take care of the kid and I'm going to earn the money.
Yep.
And that's what we've done and it's worked out reasonably well. Honestly, at 7 years old, she still doesn't have time to do things. Like, you know, we have a little farm going on, and we're busy she's busy all the time. It's not like she's sitting around watching TV, I can assure you.
Right. She doesn't have any time for a 40-hour work week, is what you're saying.
No. I mean, we'd change our lives dramatically if that's what needed to happen.
So share your thoughts if you want to join us here on parenting. Was it everything that it was cracked up to be? Did the first child dissuade you from having the second? Or are you as shocked as Mark is about the results of this survey, which are showing that a significant amount of parents are finding their loss of happiness with the birth of their first child to be more significant than the loss of happiness in divorce, unemployment, or the death of a partner.
Yeah, that sounds like crap to me.
Our toll-free number, if you want to join us with your thoughts, is 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. We also have Skype. You can Skype in here at username lrn.fm. You know, it's been a while since we've talked about the ISIS videos, Mark, but they have continued to come out. The ISIS videos, of course, they started probably a good year ago now. At this point, with John Cantley, who was hosting videos sort of shot in a basement or something like that, in a room, a very nondescript room, with just him sitting there talking to the camera.
Is he still around?
He is apparently not necessarily. There's no evidence that he's been executed, I guess.
Okay.
But we haven't seen any video from John Cantley in several months, so there are people who are worried about his well-being,
like
of course.
Me.
But the videos have escalated from the Cantley-style newsy videos to just more and more brutal decapitations and now explosions, and even the Taliban is disgusted by this latest one. We'll tell you about it.
So I say to Mark at lunch, look, you know, I keep hearing from the government that, you know, they're worried someday ISIS may get here. And I go, duh, Garland, Texas, Muhammad cartoon shooting, ISIS is already here. I'm not waiting for these people to defend me. If they don't know ISIS is here already, they got no clue, I'm taking care of myself. Guns80.com, AR-15 kits, 30-shot magazines, great prices. They've even got the Hillary special. Guns80.com, that's 844-2-GUNS-80, Guns80.com.
We use mobile devices right against our bodies every day, but growing scientific evidence has emerged showing serious health risks associated with exposure to EMF radiation emitted from these devices. The solution is Defender Shield, the most effective mobile radiation shielding ever developed. Defender Shield blocks virtually 100% of EMF radiation from cell phones, tablets, and laptops, and starts at just $64.99. Buy now at DefenderShield.com. For 10% off, use promo code GCN. DefenderShield.com, the worldwide leader in mobile radiation shielding.
Free Talk Live.
I wish you would have answered the question as to what's the age range. I mean, if two 10-year-old boys are playing doctor with each other, and he was specific that he said it was okay for a boy and a girl to play doctor, which did happen to me when I was that age, but I was maybe two and a half, three years older than that girl. Am I a molester? She was the one trying to take my pants off. Should she go to jail?
You know, people like Lou, they get all upset over things like this when they're not even apprised of the facts. And you try to tell them the facts, and they just, since it doesn't fit with their worldview,
right,
it doesn't fit with their core belief system, it's just, it can't be possibly true that I could have possibly have known what I was doing.
Children who are engaged in sex with somebody who is older are being manipulated. That's one of them. And, you know, sometimes that's, sometimes that's true.
Absolutely. There's
and
no doubt.
And sometimes it's not.
Free Talk Live, 7 nights a week from 7 to 10 Eastern, live on the Liberty Radio Network at LRN.FM.
Radio is the most personal of mediums. I exist right now in your head. If you listen to Free Talk Live regularly, you know me. Free Talk Live is on more than 160 radio stations around the U.S. and has been downloaded on every continent around the world. Hundreds of thousands of listeners with ad packages from $600 a month to $6,000 a month. Imagine what we can do for your business, project, website, or idea. Email me, Mark, at freetalklive.com. The three most important things you can do for Free Talk Live are, one, share one episode a week on Facebook or in some other social networking site. Two, buy the things you buy online through shop.freetalklive.com. Three, give $5 a month to the AMP program. It's my firm belief that Free Talk Live's AMP program is the best use of your charitable dollar among liberty-oriented organizations. Support all the organizations you love. But make sure you give $5 a month to AMP at amp.freetalklive.com.
I've been told no in many different ways.
I give you an order and you're going to obey it.
Well, George, you can go this way.
You can do that and you have to leave here.
You cannot bring Simon to their rally.
Walk with me.
Well, I'm comfortable here, actually.
Whoa, excuse me.
Who do you think you
excuse
are?
Excuse me.
There is no video and audio allowed in this office.
No, I have work today. This is...
You ain't going to make...
Wait,
you go now.
Wait a minute.
Hey! Oh my God! Unbelievable!
Why are you running from me?
Because you scared me!
What am I being detained for?
You're being served.
What is this?
You're being served.
What is this?
Bureaucrats have a funny way of telling people no. That's the sound of the men working on the chain. Derek J's Victimless Crime Spree. Watch it for free and order the Director's Cut DVD at victimlesscrimespree.com.
Listen to LRN.FM on any phone, anytime. 213-493-0309. That's 213-493-0309.
Talk Live. Dial on in here. Toll free. Join us. Talk about ISIS, parenting, anything you want to discuss. 855-450-FREE is our toll free number. 855-450-3733. We've got video. You can watch it live at cam.freetalklive.com. You can also watch it later on our YouTube channel at youtube.freetalklive.com. It'll take you right to where you need to go to watch as much Free Talk Live as you darn well care to consume. All completely free. The Cam page, by the way, has our chat room built into it, so you can actually watch, you can listen, and interact with other Free Talk Live listeners at the same time at cam.freetalklive.com. Mark, have you heard about some of the more recent ISIS videos? We've touched base on some of them here on Free Talk Live. We have not played the audio from them because they're just not interesting. Like, we'd started with the John Cantley ones, the ones like that started a year ago, I think, at this point, where he was just kind of talking into a camera, sitting at a desk in his orange jumpsuit.
We started with the guy that was the British guy. That
Jihadi John, as they call him.
Jihadi John, yeah.
And who was allegedly slicing people's heads off, but they never actually showed it in those videos.
Yeah, it's very strange stuff.
Yeah, those kind of started at around the same time, I guess, as the John Cantley ones. And And they've progressively gotten more and more violent over the last year.
Right, killing Syrian pilots and Christians and a variety of folks.
Yeah, and in mass, too. Like, yeah. the first videos were just...
having kids do the executions.
Yeah, that was one of the more concerning and really freaky ones that that has happened. And when you say kids, you mean like 8, 9, 10 years old, young boys, mm-hmm. shooting these people in the head in one video. In another video, did they have them do the decapitations? I'm losing track. There have been so many different...
I thought they did. They had one kid... do some throat slitting.
There have been mass decapitation videos that they did not cut away from. And in fact, not only did they not cut away, they did cut some out, but they, you know, they left enough of the actual footage in to make it pretty clear what was going on. Mm-hmm. And when I say they made cuts, they cut from different camera angles. So they had like zooms of the decapitations and just absolutely horrible bloodletting in some of these videos. In other news, there's now been a video that has been released, and I have yet to watch this one, but there's an article over at the Vice News, at news.vice.com, about how even the Taliban is disgusted by the Islamic State's latest video. The savagery of the so-called Islamic State, IS, has reportedly proved too extreme, even for the Taliban.
You won't believe what ISIS has done.
Yeah.
Even the Taliban is upset at this shocking video. It sounds like an upworthy.
Yeah, well, it got me to click on it, I can tell you that.
Yeah.
The Taliban is condemning the horrific video that appears to show militants blowing up bound and blindfolded Afghan prisoners with explosives. In the latest example of the ongoing battle for supremacy between insurgent groups, the Taliban issued a strongly worded response on Tuesday, denouncing the ISIS propaganda video, which appeared on jihadi social media forums on Sunday.
Right, because I don't understand. What are they doing in Afghanistan? ISIS is in Iraq. I mean, I guess they were, another offshoot was
they're
in Egypt.
They're all over the place.
Yeah, I guess.
A horrific, this is a quote from the Taliban's website, as translated by Reuters, quote, a horrific video was released yesterday showing kidnappers who associate themselves with Daesh, which is, I guess, Arabic for ISIS.
Okay.
They have IS in parentheses here. Brutally martyring several white-bearded tribal elders and villagers with explosives, said the statement on their website. The Taliban, which has itself been accused of brutality in its attacks, said the prisoners who were accused by IS as being apostates should not have been treated in such a way. It says, quote, or in their press release, quote,
I'm not sure what an apostate is. Sounds like somebody who doesn't agree with me religiously.
I think so. The offense and other such brutal actions by a few irresponsible, ignorant individuals under the guise of Islam and Muslims are intolerable, said the Taliban. The four-minute-long video released by IS shows a group of militants digging up the ground, then planting explosives in the dirt before leading blindfolded men to kneel on the ground. After detonating the explosives with the men kneeling on them, the video ends with a message in Arabic stating, quote, do you have a taste for digging your own graves? Do you want to be beheaded? Unquote. The Taliban's response comes after the group cautioned IS to back off in Afghanistan this June, warning that if the two militant groups were to become rivals in the country, decades of fighting foreign powers in the Afghan government could be undone. Patrick Skinner, director of special projects at the Sufan Group, which tracks extremists, said, I think the Taliban is a little frustrated because they've been doing 99% of the fighting for decades.
We deserve this!
Though experts say it's unclear how many resources IS has devoted to Afghanistan, in January, the group declared the country, along with Pakistan, to be part of its Khorasan province, leading militants in both countries to swear allegiance to its self-declared caliphate and carry out attacks in its name. So it sounds like they're expanding, Mark. The Taliban has long enjoyed an alliance with al-Qaeda, which until the Islamic State's rapid ascension last year was seen as the top dog among international terrorist organizations. Making matters worse for the Taliban, its top leadership is increasingly fractured, leaving it a ripe target for IS, a group that espouses fighting on a global scale and that has embraced social media. The group has recently been hit by a series of defections to IS, with some pledging allegiance to its leader Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi after and citing disillusionment with Taliban leader Mullah Omar, who was revealed to be dead last month.
So it's going to be hard to have a dead leader. You know, like that's just not going to really work for your organization.
Yeah, it sounds like things are falling apart for the Taliban. And, of course, a headline about the Taliban falling apart more than a decade ago would have been welcome news. But in this case...
This is what happens is that inside the vacuum steps another organization that's really no better than the last and worse in some cases. So... You know, I don't know why ISIS is getting all this traction in the Muslim world. I don't know why. I cannot tell you why, but it seems like there's people who are going over there to join the battle from the United States and from Great Britain. They're giving up, you know, better lives for worse ones to fight for whatever it is that they're fighting for. I don't understand it, but...
Well, some people fight for the sake of fighting, Mark. I mean, there's religious belief behind ISIS, but there are also people who they just want to fight the man, right? And certainly ISIS, Taliban, these groups have been oppressed in a lot of ways by the U.S. government meddling in these various different Middle Eastern countries. And regardless of how firm the religious beliefs are of the people who are interested in joining ISIS, if you want to fight people, and specifically the United States government, then ISIS would be a group that would welcome
you. Sign right
up
for that.
Right? You just have to act like you agree with their
crazy beliefs. You'll get to go to heaven
beliefs.
At the end, because that's what's going to happen, ultimately. I mean, ultimately what's going to happen is ISIS is going to grow large enough and powerful enough, it appears, that some coalition of governments is going to have to go put it down to their minds, and it something probably is going to grow even worse in its place.
Let's go to Nathan. He's in Texas on Skype. Hello, Nathan.
Evening, guys.
Hey, what's on your mind?
I love the new bumper music.
Thanks.
So on the
credit
topic
goes
of,
to Rebel Inc. for that.
Indeed.
Yeah.
On the topic of having children, I was wondering, I wanted to take it in a different direction. Have you heard of this new study about the welfare trap? If you type welfare trap into Google, it's the first image result.
No. Tell me about it.
It's also called the welfare cliff. It's this concept that if a family or an individual or whatever is on government assistance and also working a job, then they hit what's called a cliff where increasing their income that they take home, like the take-home pay, doesn't necessarily increase the amount of money they get.
It'll decrease it, right? It'll put them in a different category and make it so they won't get as much from welfare, right?
Exactly. The image I have shows that a single mom is better off working.
Hold that thought. We'll talk to you more about it here in a moment. More with Nathan in Texas. Your calls are welcome, whether it's on welfare or ISIS and these crazy, violent, sick videos. I'll try to find the link to the actual video and post it here. This is Free Talk Live.
Attention, business owners. Do you know the three most critical letters in business? CEO?
MBA?
Nope. Here's a hint. These three little letters can make the difference between making a fortune and losing everything.
ROI?
The answer is INC, as in incorporation. Because if you're not incorporated and someone sues your business, you can lose it all. Your home, your car, even your life savings. That's why Incorporate.com is now giving away a free incorporation guide to all business owners, so you can incorporate in just 10 minutes. Protect your home. Protect your car. Protect your life savings. Call 1-800-941-1029 for your free 10-minute incorporation guide from Incorporate.com. They don't provide legal or financial advice. They just make incorporating or forming an LLC quick and easy. Get the three little letters that can mean the difference between making a fortune and losing everything. For your free guide, call 1-800-941-1029. That's 1-800-941-1029.
You are an individual with your own thoughts, decisions, and actions. So why should you be penalized for not enrolling in the subpar health insurance mandated by the government when you can be truly independent with Liberty HealthShare, a bold, innovative alternative allowing you to take back control and make your own decisions about your health care? Mention this ad when you call to learn more. 800-714-6993. That's 800-714-6993. Liberty HealthShare. Together, we are one.
Paid non-attorney spokesperson, Adam Pulaski of the Pulaski Law Firm with principal office in Houston, Texas, is the attorney responsible for the content of this ad. This ad is not legal advice, and the choice of a lawyer should not be based solely upon advertisement. Services may not be available in all states.
Attention Xarelto users. If you or a loved one took Xarelto and suffered a serious bleeding event, you may be entitled to financial compensation. Xarelto is a popular prescription blood thinner used to prevent blood clots and protect patients from strokes. These serious bleeding events have led to numerous cases of hospitalization and even death. Phone lines are open 24/7. Call 800-261-0937. That's 800-261-0937.
Here's a breaking medical legal alert. Attention, users of the diabetes drug Actos. If you or a loved one has taken Actos, then developed bladder cancer, or if a loved one has died from bladder cancer after taking Actos, you may be entitled to significant financial compensation from the pharmaceutical giants who made these drugs. Our experienced attorneys are dedicated to help you get the money you're entitled to, but time may be running out on this opportunity. So you must call today. The information is free. There are no fees unless we win your case. If you or a loved one has developed bladder cancer or something worse after taking the diabetes drug Actos, call right now and learn your legal rights. This is an advertisement not valid in all states. I am a paid non-attorney spokesperson. Call the tort attorneys 24/7 right now. 800-430-7924. 800-430-7924. That's 800-430-7924.
You can listen to Free Talk Live on the radio, podcast, satellite, webcam, and our live streams. But did you know you can listen to Free Talk Live from any phone, anywhere? Add this number to your phone, 213-493-0308. It's a long-distance call, so make sure you're familiar with your phone's calling plan. The listen lines are airing the latest episode of Free Talk Live 24 hours a day, including our live shows. Call 213-493-0308. That's 213-493-0308. When I found the Free State Project, I knew it was the key to achieving liberty in my lifetime. It's awesome to be surrounded by like-minded, freedom-loving activists who've moved here to New Hampshire. From politics to civil disobedience, we have it all. Where I came from, it felt that no matter what I did, liberty was dying. Perhaps you feel the same way? Call 888-377-2515 now to learn more about the Free State Project. That's 888-377-2515 or visit freestateproject.org.
You can interact with other LRN listeners in our message board at forum.lrn.fm. That's forum.lrn.fm.
Hey, it's Free Talk Live. Moments remain, but enough time for you. If you join us now, toll free at 855-450-FREE. That's 855-450-3733. I did find the video of the latest ISIS horrible video, and they are showing ISIS members digging holes and putting what appear to be bombs. Probably not landmines, just bombs, just wired bombs that they can then detonate later, and then they're walking various different people from Afghanistan tribes over to this location where the bombs have been placed in the ground. We'll tell you more about it here, and I'll link to it over on our Facebook and Twitter for those of you who do want to see these kind of atrocities. Our toll-free number again, 855-450-FREE. But Nathan was telling us about welfare cliffs, and can you describe again for our listeners just tuning in what that is?
Sure. So there's actually not a single welfare program that's just called welfare, right? So there's SNAP, there's housing benefits, there's Medicaid, there's the EITC. I think that's a child care benefit of some kind. And so they all, have different values at different amounts of income, say, that you might have. And the net result is that you might get into a situation where you are making more money at your job, but when you get that raise, you actually lose money because the government program that's giving you the benefits decides to, you know, cut off that amount. I think it's called means testing. You know, you might reach a cutoff where if you make such and such dollars per year, then they'll cut whatever the program might be. So Medicaid or EITC or whatnot.
So there's a disincentive to make more money because you'll get off the welfare.
Exactly. And so this image is I'm looking at from Google calculates that if a single mother is working about $29,000 a year, she'll make the same amount as if she was working $60,000 a year or $69,000 a year, because either way, they come out to the same level of lifestyle of about $57,000 a year.
Yeah, so basically, if you this is a disincentive for single mothers to earn anything more than $29,000 a year, until you're talking about making a paycheck of $69,000 a year. And I don't know how many Americans make $69,000 a year individually, mm-hmm. Who have kids at the same time. How many single mothers in America make $69,000 a year? But I would guess that it's single digits as far as percentages go. So, you know, it truly disincentivizes women from earning more money in this area. Also, it disincentivizes commitment to marriage and these sorts of things, too.
And yeah, and that's I wanted to tie it in with the parenthood discussion, because I was actually curious about, you know, what do people sort of talk about getting out of welfare or rising out above it or whatever. I found surprisingly little on just a Google search and a YouTube search. Most of the things out there seem to be about, you know, telling people to get a job or, you know, just talking about it as a policy problem, not actually talking about how you would actually go about getting out of the welfare trap. And a thread that I saw or that I seem to notice is that a lot of it seemed to be predicated on having children in the first place, meaning a lot of it was talking about single mothers, two parents, couples, et cetera. And I was kind of left with the conclusion that maybe if you have children, then it really is a trap, because once you have children, a lot of the avenues that you might use to get out of this welfare trap or welfare cliff suddenly become unavailable. Like, you can't just pick up and move somewhere, right? Or
it's more difficult, and it's more difficult to get jobs when you've got a child, just because you've got to dedicate time to the children or hire a babysitter, and that makes things difficult. Well, why would you want to get a job when you can get paid to sit at home with your kids from the government?
What I'm amazed at, what I'm looking at here is that I'm looking at things like a woman who's making $5,000 a year, or slightly under $5,000 a year, and that's a pretty low pay, slightly under $10,000 a year, really low pay here, can get benefits, if they have children, up to $55,000 worth of benefits.
Sign me up.
Right. Well, that's kind of I literally had the conversation with my wife recently. How about I just quit working and you go on welfare? Because the fact is, she could do quite well, you know, on that. And, you know, obviously she told me to get back to work. But, yeah. You know, it's.
She wouldn't need you anymore.
These are realities.
$50,000, that's enough to take care of a kid and not have you around, buddy.
Indeed.
Exactly.
Nathan, anything else you want to share? Go ahead.
It just seems frightening to me because, I mean, obviously, if you don't have children, that could be a factor in improving your living standard. You know, you could go to school, or you could, invest in career training or move to another place. But then once you have a child, it seems like it really is a trap, that there's sort of no way out of it, or that it'd be extremely difficult for the average person to get out of it. And just, it seems like a lot of people.
And by out of it, you don't mean having a child, you mean getting out of welfare.
Right, right. Okay. Getting sort of becoming independent and working for yourself. And I don't know. I just don't feel that a lot of people have empathy or recognize the difficulty that a lot of poor people are placed in, because when they face these incentives, they act rationally. They act like you or I would. And they calculate that. You know, if I
make more
raise,
than $29,000 a year, if I make $30,000 a year instead of $29,000 a year, my benefits plummet from $57,000 a year to $49,000 a year. Why in the world would I take an $8,000 a year cut to make $1,000 more per year? This is crazy.
Yeah, and you're working more hours, right?
Right. So please cut my hours.
Yeah. And since a lot of these benefits are directly benefits to the children that you have, so it puts you in another quandary. Of, you know, you have an obligation to take care of your children, so you could actually hurt your children by not taking it because you're making so little.
I think that a lot of people, the question they're asking here is that, do we want to, because obviously you want to help somebody who's in a bad situation, but you don't want to incentivize somebody who to continue digging the hole by, you know, and children are a huge net negative on your income. So if you have a kid accidentally,
it can be a death sentence as far as your career goes in later in life. But if you just give people money based on how many children they have, surprise, surprise, people are going to have some more children in order to get more of that money.
Thanks, Nathan, for your call tonight. Appreciate hearing from you via our Skype, which is Skype username lrn.fm. So feel free to reach out to us that way. The video that is disgusting even the Taliban by ISIS is actually not as, on the scale of ISIS violence and gore, it is not the most gory video because it is an explosive video. They're showing bodies being exploded.
And there's not much to see after that. It's just like, there's the bodies, and then kaboom.
Yeah. And they don't cut away in this video. They do show the actual, from a distance, you know, this group of people that have been...
Because you don't want to show that up close. You'll die.
You could put the camera up close, I guess, and hope that it survives. So they had the camera far enough away to where it survived the explosions and also shows pretty crystal clear here what happens to the people, which it's... I've actually got the audio from the video here. They've even got sound effects. You know, you heard the sort of the build-up sound effect right before that. These are very, very well-produced videos, and then now they're showing chunks. I guess that's pretty gory. Showing, like, chunks of people's bodies after this. I think they had like a computer-generated graphic of a bomb at the very beginning of like the titles of this particular video were sort of made up to look like those plunger bombs or whatever you've seen on the cartoons.
Yeah, I wonder if you get a better place in heaven for being the graphic artist on one of these videos. I mean, is that helpful in that way?
They are, you got to hand it to them. They have a talent when it comes to putting video productions together. They've got some. People that know their stuff when it comes to editing.
I can't believe people are rushing to the aid of this organization. I mean, I don't get it. I don't understand why people are like so excited. So many Muslims are excited about this ISIS organization to the point that they're ready to, sign up and get on board. I mean, I guess they're just frustrated with the U.S. foreign policy or the Western foreign policy that intervenes in their area. I don't have any idea what the reasons are, but... Here's the little handwriting on the wall, folks. These Western nations are only going to put up with this for so long, and then they're going to come in, and they're going to kill everybody. Yeah, boom, boom, boom. This is what your life's going to be
like. And you're hearing multiple explosions because they're reversing and playing it again and again. So there was only one blast, but they just keep
I was going to say the timing really sounds like it'd be crappy. But you probably couldn't wire bombs to do that because the wires would get blown up as the first bomb went off.
So that's the latest. Even the Taliban is sickened by this. You can see the video. We posted it on our Facebook and Twitter. We'll be back tomorrow night. You can join us between now and then. In the meantime, at freetalklive.com.
Free Press Publications is an independent, alternative media and publishing company founded in June 2009 with the mission of ensuring a free press for the freedom movement and is committed to spreading the message of peace, freedom, love, and liberty. FPP also gives new authors an avenue for publishing freedom-oriented material. FPP brings you daily news and commentary on the website fpp.cc, as well as a daily 5-minute newscast, FPP Radio News, and weekly news, views, and commentary in the FPP Freedom Minute and Peace, Love, Liberty Radio at fppradio.com, and the monthly newspaper FPP News at news.fpp.cc. Find FPP online at fpp.cc. That's fpp.cc, as in Creative Commons.
This Your Family Today tip is brought to you by Lil Drums. Every bit as fun as a full-size Nestle drumstick cone and definitely cuter. Visit us at drumstick.com. Vacations are all about family time, but you don't have to leave home to have fun. Take one weekend a month and devote it to family activities. Pull out the board games and puzzles, serve up some treats, or have a picnic. Even without leaving home, you'll feel like you've really had some time away. For more tips like these, visit us at parenthood.com/yourfamilytoday.
Did you know that you can listen to and watch Free Talk Live during our live show 7 days a week from 7 to 10 p.m. Eastern via our studio cam at chem.freetalklive.com? Not only that, but you can also chat with other listeners at the same time. Do I need to mention that both the studio cam and chat room are totally free? Outside of Free Talk Live's live hours, you won't see a cam feed, but we'll hear audio from the Liberty Radio Network. So listen, watch, and chat all free at cam.freetalklive.com. That's cam.freetalklive.com.
The live edition of Liberty Conspiracy is next, after the news, here on the Liberty Radio Network, LRN.FM.
From Keene in the Shire, the Liberty Media capital of the world, this is Daryl W. Perry, host of FPP Radio News for Sunday, August 16th, 2015. Silver is trading at $15.26 per ounce. Gold is valued at $1,115 per ounce. And according to BitcoinAverage.com, the average price of Bitcoin is $261. Antiwar.com reports several months into the Saudi Arabia-led war against Yemen's Shiite Houthis, the pro-Saudi faction, the former government led by Abd Rabu Mansour Hadi, has gained a little bit of territory around Aden, and that has raised international calls for some sort of settlement leading to elections. That's not seemingly likely, however, with Hadi government officials still talking up a full-scale military victory nationwide after having taken one city and some nearby towns. The group's ambassador to the UN says victory is assured. Ambassador Ali Mani said of the Houthis, "They are on the run," adding, "My feelings is this is going to be weeks before we can liberate the entire country from the coup." Regional diplomats aren't nearly so optimistic and are urging the two sides to talk and settle things. Hadi was a military leader elected in a single-candidate vote in 2013 after the Arab Spring resignation of longtime dictator Ali Abdullah Saleh. Hadi resigned himself in January after an offensive against the Houthis turned sour and the Houthis took over the capital. The UN already brokered one round of peace talks in Switzerland, but it failed when the two sides would not meet in the same room. The only time they were together turned ugly when Hadi envoys attacked a Houthi spokesman at a press conference. Bitcoin Not Bombs is a launching pad for nonprofits and social entrepreneurs into the financial freedom of the Bitcoin economy. Bitcoin Not Bombs is fully committed to being the hub of the nonprofit sector of the Bitcoin economy. To learn more, visit BitcoinNotBombs.com. UPI reports flights in airspace along the East Coast were disrupted for hours on Saturday due to a technical glitch at the Federal Aviation Administration's Northern Virginia Control Center. Officials said the glitch occurred in an automated system at the agency's Air Traffic Control Center in Leesburg, Virginia, affecting flights leaving and arriving at multiple airports in the New York City and Washington, D.C. areas. As those airports are responsible for a great share of the East Coast air traffic, the glitch caused cancellations, delays, and reroutes, according to the FAA. Just after 2 p.m. Eastern Time on Saturday, the agency said the system was back online. The New York City area airports operate traffic for some of the most congested airspace in the world. The FAA did not specify exactly how many flights were disrupted, but it did say the glitch was not a result of a security breach.
For over 35 years, Roberts & Roberts has been a trusted source for buying and selling your investment-grade precious metals. They also take Bitcoin for precious metal purchases and permanently removed the minimum purchase order for all orders paid in the digital currency. Call Roberts & Roberts today for knowledgeable advice on investing and a forward-thinking approach to new technologies. 850-478-5270 or online at rrbi.co.
Reuters reports telecommunication powerhouse AT&T has provided extensive assistance to the U.S. National Security Agency as the spy agency conducts surveillance on huge volumes of internet traffic passing through the United States. The New York Times reported on Saturday, citing newly disclosed NSA documents, that the company gave technical assistance to the NSA in carrying